Hi everyone, I'm Katrina, and in this video, let's go over how to create a customized business website using the amazing Genesis framework by Studio Press and the Studio Press child theme called Executive Pro. So I received this request from Steve and Sally in Seattle. Thank you so much for the great suggestion. I love this theme. This is a really great theme for a business website. So let's take a quick tour around the website we'll be creating in this video. So here we are on the homepage of the website we'll be creating in this video, and as we can see at the top, we'll have our logo or website title and a tagline along with the menu items here in the header section. Just under this, we'll have our full width image slider with an image and then this box here where you can add some calls to action. Underneath the slider, we'll have a horizontal email opt-in form. Note that this is above the fold, which means that we can see it before we scroll down the page. It's always a really great idea to both have an email opt-in form on your page so that you can start collecting email addresses and staying in touch with people who are interested in your business. And it's also really important to keep this above the fold because studies show that a lot of times people actually, when they come to your website, they actually don't scroll down the page. So in this video, I'm going to show you how to create a horizontal email opt-in form just under the image slider. Next, underneath that, we'll have some other calls to action. Now these are totally customizable. That's the great thing about this particular theme. Everything is really customizable. I'm going to be adding some images with some calls to action, some words on them that are essentially calls to action, learn, shop, and hire me. But in this particular section, you can also add post or other kind of actual written text content, and I'll show you that in just a moment. But in this video, when we are completed with this video, this is what we'll have. We'll have these three different additional call to action sections here, which are represented by these blocks. Underneath that, then we'll have our footer section, and the great thing once again with the footer section is that this is all customizable content, so you can add anything that you'd like in this area right here, and I'll show you how to do that in this video. I'm going to be adding a search box, some social network icons, a short description about my website, as well as a video. Now, going up to the top, when I click on the About page, we're also going to be adding an About page because most likely you're going to want to have an About page about your business. So in this video, I'm going to show you how to create a page where it'll have content on the left-hand side and the sidebar on the right-hand side. And the other great thing, once again, about this particular theme is that so many different pieces of it are fully customizable. So, for example, if you prefer to have a full width page instead of a page with content and a sidebar, I'll show you how to do that as well. Next, I'm also going to show you how to create a photo gallery page, or in this section, I'm going to call it a shop page, because the really great thing about this particular photo gallery is that it can operate and function a lot of different ways, and I'm going to show you three different ways in this video to set up your photo gallery. Number one, I'm going to show you how to set it up so that when you click on an image, it will open it up into a really beautiful light box display. So if you want to just feature your images, you can do so in this light box display like that. Or if you want to feature affiliate products, say you have an affiliate account and you want to feature products that you are promoting as an affiliate, I'm going to show you how to create the image gallery, the photo gallery here, so that when you click on one of these images, say this one for example, it'll go directly to whatever affiliate product that you'd like it to go to. So in this instance, I've set it up with Amazon, so it's going to go directly to my Amazon page. But of course, I'll show you in this video how you can customize that link to go to any external web page that you would like. So I'm also going to show you in this video how to set up your photo gallery so that in the event that you would also like each of these images to go to an internal page on your website, it can also do that as well. So as an example, when I click on this image right here, it'll go to an internal page on my own website where I'm talking about this particular product, this juice. So anyway, I'm going to show you three different ways with the photo gallery how to set that up. Number one, how to create a light box. Number two, how to link to an external website. And number three, how to link to an internal page. Okay, moving on to the blog section. We'll also have a blog in this website. Having a blog is a great way to provide fresh content to your readers. And so this will be our blog section right here. Also note that on the right-hand sidebar, I'm going to feature a search box. box so anyone can easily search throughout the website any kind of content they may be looking for. Also, we're going to add once again our email opt-in form. Note that this is totally customized, so I'll show you how to customize all the colors in this video. I'm also going to be adding in the sidebar these social network icons so anyone can easily connect with me on the social web. I'm going to include a Twitter timeline tweet right here, and then I'm going to include some recent posts. So that is what the sidebar is going to look like. Once again, like the footer, the sidebar is completely customizable, so I'll show you how you can add other content if you prefer to have other content instead of what I'll be adding right here in the video. Okay, so taking a quick look at one of the blog posts, I'm going to click on this one right here, this detox juice cleanse, and here we're on the single blog post. So here we'll have an image, so I'll show you how to add an image to your website along with some written content. Then underneath that we'll have an email opt-in form. Once again, note that I have these email opt-in forms everywhere on the site because, again, having an email opt-in form on your website is a great way to capture leads, and that is always a good thing. It's also a great way to stay in touch with people who are interested in your business. Underneath the email opt-in form, we'll also have some social sharing features so anyone can easily share your content across the social web, either to Facebook, Google+, Twitter, Pinterest, or some other social network. Then finally at the bottom, we'll have this customized content form here using the Jetpack plugin. So I'll show you how to set that up in this video. Okay, now moving on, we'll also have a contact page on this website. This is a great way for anyone who's visiting to contact you directly from within your website with just by filling out this form and then clicking on the send button. And then finally, we're going to have a resources page, or it could be really anything you'd like. Essentially, this is a landing page where you can note that the logo is gone, all the menu items have disappeared here. This is just really focused on the content itself and on any kind of calls to action or promotions that you may want to feature on your website. So this is a landing page, and I'll show you how to add your email opt-in form at the bottom to your landing page. Okay, so going back, there's one or two other things that I want to point out about this website. Going back to the home page, I'm also going to be showing you how to set up video on your posts or pages. So when I click on this Learn page, here I've just added some demo videos right here, so you can see there's all these different videos. Adding videos in WordPress is really easy, so I'll show you in this video how to add videos to your posts and pages. So this is where we're headed toward in this video. This is a very customizable business website, and not only is it customizable in terms of the layout and the different sections that you add, the different content that you add to either the sidebar or the footer or on the homepage, but I'm also going to show you step by step from scratch how to customize the colors, the fonts, and the overall look and design of this entire website. So this is the completed customized version. When we go to the demo site at StudioPress, if you make no customizations, then you'll see this is what it will look like instead. So we'll have a black box on the left-hand side. The fonts are somewhat smaller. There are these drop-down boxes. I'll show you in this video how you can do that if you'd like. And then we have underneath this, you note that there's many different sections to the home page. Now, I've removed some of the sections, but I will show you how you can add them in this video. So here, for example, on this demo, there's these three different sections. And here, note, not only do they have images, but they also have titles and text. Then they have this call to action banner. I will go over that in this video. And then they have some more sections right here. As we can see, we can customize this theme in a variety of different ways, which makes it a great theme for a variety of different businesses. As mentioned, we're going to be using the amazing Genesis framework for this particular website. So I want to take a quick moment to head on over to StudioPress.com to go over some of the top reasons to use Genesis. So StudioPress has been recognized throughout the web world for their amazing WordPress framework called Genesis and the many child themes that they offer with this framework. As we see here, Genesis and their child themes have been downloaded by over 100,000 website owners. So over 100,000 websites trust StudioPress and the Genesis framework to power their website. So you can be really rest assured that this is a really amazing framework to use for your WordPress website. You can check out all the different reasons, the 8 reasons to choose the Genesis framework here on StudioPress.com. Of the many reasons to choose the Genesis framework, here are some of the top reasons at a glance. Number 1, rock solid security. Number 2, blazing fast performance. Number 3, out of the box SEO. Number 4, beautiful mobile responsive designs. And number 5, ultra flexible foundational code. So the great news with Genesis is that not only are you getting a beautiful design on the outside, but you can be rest assured that the code that is actually generating your website is state-of-the-art code. It's clean, it's optimized, and it adheres to the latest WordPress security standards. And it's for these reasons that over 100,000 website owners, including many of the web's leading internet marketers, bloggers, media producers, and developers, trust the Genesis framework along with the StudioPress child themes to serve their content. So this is where we're headed toward in this video. We're going to be creating a customized business website using the Genesis framework and the child theme called Executive Pro. This website is a mobile-friendly, responsive website, which means it's going to look amazing both on desktops and laptops, as well as on mobile devices. There's a quick demo of the responsiveness of this website. When I come to the bottom right-hand size and reduce the screen size, note that all the different elements on the page are moving. They're stacking up one by one vertically until finally we get to the smartphone view. This is a view that we can expect on a mobile device. We can see we'll have the logo at the top. Now we can see the menu items right here. The slider has now been reduced, so we can see that right there. It will continue to revolve and transition. Then we have our email opt-in form, and then all the other elements on the page are really nicely stacked up vertically one by one, so they can all be very easily read on a smaller screen size like a mobile device. So this is where we're headed toward in this video. Let's get started.
So before we get started, how much is this website going to cost? Well, we need several things. Number one, we need a domain name, and we also need web hosting. In this video, I'm going to be using HostGator.com, and at HostGator, you can get both the domain name as well as the web hosting. I'm also going to be using a special coupon code at HostGator.com to get an extra amount off my order. There's 2 coupons to choose from depending on which web hosting plan is preferred. So if you decide to go with HostGator.com, feel free to use these coupons as well to get an extra amount off of your order as well. If you sign up for 1 month hosting at HostGator.com, the best coupon to use is WP Coupon 25. And if you sign up for 6 months or more of web hosting at HostGator.com, the best coupon code to use is thank you. So be sure to refer to these coupons if you'd like to get an extra discount when you sign up at HostGator.com. Also, I do want to note, I do receive a small referral from HostGator if you decide to use these coupons and if you go with them. So thank you in advance for your support and helping me to continue to create these free WordPress training videos. I've also noted additional web hosts and deals on my website at 77webstudio.com/deals. Once we have the domain name and the web hosting, the next thing we'll need is a Genesis framework and the Executive Pro child theme, both of which we can get at studiopress.com for $99.95. So this is a little bit more than many of the other premium WordPress themes out there in the online marketplaces, but keep in mind that this is a package that we're getting, which includes both the theme as well as the Genesis framework. This is a one-time purchase fee, and it also includes unlimited updates and unlimited support. Once we have the domain name, web hosting, and the framework and the theme, the next thing that we'll need to put this together is some time, and I'm estimating this should take roughly just under 3 hours. So please set aside about 3 hours or just under to go through the video, watch the tutorial, and put together the website. So in sum, the total to get started with this particular website is around $125. Again, that's using coupon codes WPCoupon25 when you sign up for 1 month hosting at HostGator, or using coupon code thank you when you sign up for 6+ months or more of web hosting at HostGator.com. Considering that we're going to be creating a completely customized professional WordPress website using the Genesis framework, this price of $125 to get started is a really amazing value. So what are the steps we need to take to create this WordPress website? Well, the first step is we need to get a domain and the web hosting. The second step is we need to install WordPress. And number three, we need to build out the website. So let's take care of step number one, getting a domain name and the web hosting by heading over to HostGator.com. Here on HostGator.com, to view the web hosting plans, go ahead and click on the button in the middle that says View Web Hosting Plans, and then you'll see there's three different web plans to choose from. We have the Hatchling plan, the Baby plan, and the Business plan. If you're just getting your website up and running, or if you have a small business website, then most likely the Hatchling plan or the Baby plan will be a good fit for you. The difference between these two is that with the Hatchling plan, you can host one single domain name, whereas with the Baby plan, you can host as many website domains as you would like. So there's definitely more of a value when you're looking at the Baby plan. So go ahead and choose the one that is best for you. I'm going to choose the Baby plan, so I'm just going to click on order now for the Baby plan. And then we see that the next step is we need to enter our domain. So if you already have a domain name, go ahead and click on this button here to let them know that you already have your domain name. I'm actually going to register a brand new domain, so I'm just going to enter my domain name here. So just to see if something is available, I'm going to put a random name there. And of course it is available because it's super random. Once you have your domain name added and once you can see the message here that it is available, then go ahead and scroll down and the next step is we need to choose the package type. When you come to this section, the default package type that HostGator will display is 20% off with a 36-month cycle. So if you're just getting your WordPress website up and running, I usually prefer to just go month to month. So in that case, I would change this cycle here to be 1 month at 20% off. Now, I do have a coupon to get more off the order if you're signing up for 1 month. If you're signing up for 6 months, 12 months, 24 months, or 36 months, I have a different coupon to use that gives you more of a discount than what the standard discount is that HostGator is providing. So to see how that works out, I'm going to start with the first coupon code, which is WPCoupon25. And when we sign up, for example, of 1 month, then when you scroll down here, you'll note that there's a coupon code here that HostGator provides, and this is the standard coupon code, which we can see here will give you a total of $65. Now, if you put in the coupon code WPCoupon25 in this instance, and then click on validate, note that now the coupon is now $57, so that's less than the standard coupon. Now there's a lot of different add-ons that HostGator provides here, including site lock and site backup and domain privacy, and most of these I usually do not use because I have other plugins that I use to do the same things, and that way I don't have to pay an ongoing charge. So I am going to actually uncheck these two. If you'd like to sign up for these, by all means, continue to keep those checked. And the other thing I just want to show you for pricing, I'm going to remove this privacy just for the moment to show you how this works out. So now when I scroll down using a 1 month web hosting plan and the coupon code WPCoupon25, the total is less than $15, which is really, really great. Now, if you are signing up for more than 1 month, if you want to sign up for a billing cycle of say 6 months, 12 months, 24 or 36 months, I'll go with say 6 months right here, then the coupon code to use is thank you. So note that now when I use coupon WPCoupon25, the total is $62 for 6 months. But when I type in the coupon code thank you and then click on validate, now the price drops to $56. So the best coupon to use if you're signing up for 6 months or more is thank you. This is an exclusive 30% off coupon that HostGator has given me generously to share with all of my viewers. So thanks so much, HostGator, for providing me with this exclusive coupon. Okay, once you have your order, I'm actually going to go back up here and I'm actually going to add in just 1 month. Right now, 1 month, I'm going to sign up for 1 month right here. And instead of using the coupon code thank you, I'll just go back to my other coupon, WPCoupon25, and I will click on validate. And now we see that my order total is less than $15. Now keep in mind that one of the things I did turn off is privacy protection. I actually do recommend using the privacy protection or signing up for this. And here's why. When you do not sign up for privacy protection, then by default, all of your information like your email address, your address, and your website domain, and sometimes your phone number will be included in the public online database related to domain names. So if you prefer to keep all of that kind of personal contact info private, then the privacy protection is what you'll need to sign up for. So I do think this is a really good thing to sign up for. So in this case, I'm going to sign up for this one add-on of privacy protection. So once I've clicked on that box and signed up for that, now when I scroll down, my order total will recalculate and it's less than $25. Again, that's using coupon code WPCoupon25. And also a reminder, if you do sign up for more than 6 months, 6 months of web hosting or more, then go ahead and use the coupon code thank you and you will get the best deal for between these two coupons. Okay, so once you have the coupon code that you need there, go up to the top. We also need to create a username and a security PIN and fill out our billing info. And when you have all that filled out, then come to the bottom here and click on create an account to create your account and sign up for web hosting. So once you click on create your account, you'll get this page, which will thank you for your order and will tell you to go check your email for information related to logging into your web hosting account. So I'm going to go check out my email. And here we see on my email account, here's the email from HostGator with my account info. So I'm going to click this email to open it. And I want to point out two things. Number one, the first link that they'll share with you in the email is the billing system link. So if you want to check out any info related to your billing, you can go ahead and click on this link and use the password that they give you. And then right below that, you'll see that there's a link for your control panel with your username and a temporary password. So I'm going to copy this password here, the temporary password, and to log into your control panel, you'll use this link. So this is a really good email to keep in a safe place for future reference because you will be needing this information as well as the link to the control panel to log into your HostGator web hosting account. So I'm going to click on this link here, and then here is my username. You want to type in your username here that was found in the email, and then you want to add your password right here as well. Once you have that set up, you want to click on login to log into the control panel of your web hosting account. So here we are on the HostGator control panel. The next step that we want to do is step number two. We want to install WordPress. And thankfully with HostGator, there's a really easy way to install WordPress using their simple wizard script. So I am going to scroll down to where that is located. You want to scroll down to where it says software and services, and you want to find this icon that says quick install. So this is what we're going to use to install WordPress really easily in HostGator. We're going to use this quick install link. So I'm going to click on that. And once I click on that, you'll note that there's all these different kinds of software listed here on the left-hand sidebar. So right at the top, you'll note that it says blog software, and there's a link here for WordPress. This is what we want to install, so I'm going to click on that. Then we'll arrive on this page, and we can see at the time of this recording, we will be installing WordPress version 3.8. That's the most recent version of WordPress. So the next step is we need to click on this button here that says continue, and here you'll get a panel where you can decide which domain to install WordPress to. So I'm going to add the domain name where I want to install WordPress, and then I'm going to fill out this information below, starting with the admin email. So I'm going to add my admin email right there. Next, you want to give your new website a title, so I'll just call this the name of my domain. And then also you want to add an admin username. Now note that this is an important step for website security. You want to make sure that you do not use an admin that is something like admin, support, or administration. These three names, admin, support, and administration, those are the first names that hackers will try when they're attempting to break into your WordPress website. So it's important that you use an admin username that is more unique than admin. So for this instance, I'm just going to add my name right here. You can also add your first name and last name. I'm going to leave that empty, and instead I'm just going to click on install to install WordPress. Okay, congratulations, your installation is ready. So you can access the installation of your new website by clicking on this link here. And also note that here is the admin area login URL that you'll use in the future to access the login panel. To access your website in the future, you want to make a note of this link here. It's usually your domain name followed by WP-admin. So that's an important link to remember as well, so that going forward you can easily log into your WordPress website. Also make a note of your username and password. This is what you will also need, of course, to log into your website when you click on this link. So I'm just going to highlight this temporary password here and copy it. And then I'm going to click on this link here to log into my new WordPress website. So here we are on the login screen of our WordPress website. To log in, you want to enter your username in the username field and your password in the password field. And then you want to click on this button that says Remember Me, so that the next time you come to WordPress, your username and password will be remembered. In the event that you forget your password in the future, or perhaps even now, you want to click on this link here that says Lost Your Password, and WordPress will send you a password reset to the email that you used when you were creating your WordPress website. So for the moment, here I have my username and password. I'm going to go ahead and click on the login button to log in to the WordPress website. So here we are on the dashboard. This is the first thing that you'll see when you log in to your WordPress website. And when you first install WordPress, you'll also see this message that says, Welcome to WordPress, with a number of links here to get started. So I'm going to be covering these links in more detail later on in the video. So right now, I'm just going to dismiss this welcome message by clicking on the dismiss link right here. On the dashboard here, we can see at a glance we're running the 2014 theme. This is a theme that comes with our WordPress 3.8 installation. And at the time of this recording, WordPress 3.8 is the most recent version of WordPress. Okay, so to look at the website, at what it looks like now, right out of the box when we install WordPress, I'm going to come up to the top, hover over the website name, and click on Visit Site. Here we can see this is what our website looks like now when we first install WordPress version 3.8 with the 2014 theme. Of course, we have quite a bit of work to do because where we are headed toward in this video is this view. This will be our end result when we've completed this video using the Executive Pro Genesis theme by StudioPress. So the first thing that we need to do to move in this direction is we need to change our theme from the 2014 theme to the Executive Pro Genesis theme. So to change our theme, I'm going to go back to my dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to Appearance and click on Themes. And here on the theme screen, we can add a new theme by clicking on Add New. Next, we see that there's this upload link, so I'm going to click on Upload. And here we can upload the zip format file of the Executive Pro theme. So the next step is we need to go download that theme from StudioPress. Here at StudioPress.com, the next step is we need to find the Executive Pro theme. So to do that, I'm going to come up to the top here and click on Shop for Themes. And here on the WordPress themes page, we can check out all the amazing designs at StudioPress. So the design that I want is the Executive Pro theme, which is a business theme. So I'm going to do a filter search here for business. And here in the search results, we can see in the second row is the Executive Pro theme. So I'm going to click on See Details and Pricing to go directly to the Executive Pro theme page. And I'll be sure to drop the link in this video so you can easily find it. Here on the right-hand side, we can see we can buy both the theme and the Genesis framework for just under $100. So this is something that I want to point out because this price may seem a little high compared to other WordPress themes in other marketplaces, but I want to emphasize this is actually an amazing value because we're not just buying the Executive Pro theme, we're also buying the Genesis framework. The other important thing that I want to mention is that this is a one-time purchase fee and we get unlimited updates and support. So that is really important when you're buying a theme. Not all developers provide ongoing updates. Some developers down the road, maybe in a year or so, they'll require you to repurchase the theme in order to get the updates. That's not the case with StudioPress themes. It is a one-time purchase fee with unlimited updates and support. The other thing I want to mention is that because it's a one-time purchase, especially of the Genesis framework, if in the future you decide to change your theme from the Executive Creative Pro theme to another theme, then at that time in the future, you will not need to buy the Genesis framework all over again because you will already own it. As an example, a couple years ago, I bought the Genesis framework for another website project using the Mocha theme. So this time for this video, to buy the Executive Pro theme, I did not need to repurchase the Genesis framework, which was really awesome. So that is the scoop on this package deal right here. If you do not own the Genesis framework, then you'll want to click on this link to buy the theme and the framework. And if you already own the Genesis framework, you can scroll down and log in as a returning customer. You can log in for special pricing and options on the Executive Pro theme. So I've already bought this, so I'll see you inside my account where we can download the theme and the framework. So here we are inside my account at Studio Press. You want to click on downloads here to go to the downloads page where all of the themes that you've purchased will be listed. So here we see my different themes, the two that we need to download right now. We need to download both the Executive Pro Child theme as well as the Genesis framework. So I'm going to click on this button here to download the Executive Pro theme. And once the Executive Pro theme has been downloaded, I'm also going to download the Genesis framework by clicking on this button right here. Once the two files have been downloaded, the next step is we need to install the theme into our WordPress website. So going back to my WordPress website to the install theme screen, we can see we can install a theme in .zip format. So looking at the two folders that have just been downloaded, both the Executive Pro theme folder as well as the Genesis theme folder, here we can see these are both in folder form. They're not actually in .zip format. So we need to compress these. So I'm on a Mac. You can either click on this folder here and click on the control key, or you can simply come up to the top where it says file, and then you can click on compress to compress this folder. I'm going to do the same thing for the Genesis theme. I'm just going to click on it once to highlight it. Then I'm going to come up to my Mac on the file here. I'm going to click on file, and then I'm going to click on compress to compress this folder as well. If you're on a PC, I believe it's right click compress or file new compress. And so once you compress the folder, then we can upload it directly from within WordPress. If you do not have a compressed folder, you can also import or upload the folder via FTP. And I'll drop a link in this video so that you can check out my other video on how to set up FTP and how to upload folders from your computer via FTP. Once again, if you have a compressed folder format, as we've just done just now, it's really simple. You can just install the .zip format directly from within WordPress. So since I have two zipped formats right now, I'm just going to choose them one by one by clicking on choose file. The first one that I'm going to install is the Genesis file. So I'm going to highlight genesis.zip and click on choose. Then I'm going to click on install now. Once the theme has been successfully installed, I'm going to click on activate to activate the new theme. Once Genesis has been installed and activated, the next step is we need to install the child theme called Executive Pro. So once again, I'm going to click on the add new button right here. Then I'm going to click on the upload link, and this time I'm going to choose the Executive Pro zip file. So I just clicked on choose file and then executivepro.zip, and then I'm going to click on choose. Once you can see the little icon right here with Executive Pro, go ahead and click on install now to also install the Executive Pro child theme. Once the Executive Pro child theme has been installed, the next step is we need to activate the theme by clicking on activate. So here we have the two themes that we've just uploaded to our WordPress website. And in the event that you're wondering, why do I need two themes for this website? I want to go over briefly the difference between these two and how they interact. So jumping back to the Studio Press website right here, there's a really cool diagram that shows in a visual way how the framework, how WordPress, and how the child theme interact. So looking at this diagram, we can see that WordPress acts as the engine of the car. It's what powers the website. Genesis, on the other hand, acts as the frame and the body of the website. And we can consider the Studio Press Executive Pro child theme as the paint job, the designs and styles of the site. So when we buy this package, once again, we get the framework, which is essentially the parent theme, and then we get the executive pro child theme as well. Now, it's important to note, whenever we are making customizations to a parent theme, it's always really important to have a child theme, because when the developer comes out with new updates to the code of the parent theme, if we do not have a child theme, then our changes could be lost. The good news is that we're all safe and ready to go because we do have a child theme here as well as the parent theme. I'll be showing you in just a few moments how to create a custom style sheet, and I'll go over the importance of that for the Executive Pro theme in just a moment. For now, just keep in mind that we have both of these themes enabled. We have them installed and we have the Executive Pro theme activated. So if you've made it this far, then let's continue by adding some really important plugins to make this work as well. So going to the left-hand side, the next step is I'm going to hover over plugins and click on Add New. And here on the install plugin screen, we need to install three different plugins. Now, I'm going to be following the Executive Pro theme setup, which are instructions that you can get within your account. So when I click back on the downloads, when I click on downloads there, when I scroll down to Executive Pro, you can see there's this link here that says theme setup. When I click on that, these are the written instructions for this particular theme. So scrolling down here, we can see all the different links in written format, how we can set up the theme. So the three plugins that we need following along right here, we need the Genesis eNews Extended plugin, the Genesis Responsive Slider plugin, and the Regenerate Thumbnails plugin. So the first one that I'm going to add to the website is the eNews Extended plugin. So here on my install plugin screen, I'm just going to do a search for Genesis eNews Extended. Here it is right here. Then I'm going to click on Install Now. Do you sure you want to install this? Yes, okay. Once the plugin has been successfully installed, I'm going to click on Activate Plugin to activate the plugin. Okay, once a plugin has been activated, the next plugin we need to add is the Responsive Slider. So I'm going to come to Install Plugins one more time. I'm going to add a search here for the Genesis Responsive Slider and click on Search Plugins. Here we can see it's the first one at the top, developed by StudioPress right here. So I'm going to install this by clicking on Install Now. Are you sure you want to install this plugin? Yes, okay. And once the plugin has been successfully installed, I'm going to click on Activate Plugin to activate the plugin. Once this plugin has been activated, the next one that we need is Regenerate Thumbnails. So once again, I'm going to click on Add New. Then here in the search field, I'm going to do a search for Regenerate Thumbnails, and then I'm going to click on Search Plugins to search for this plugin. Here it is at the top, so I'm going to click on Install Now once again. Are you sure you want to install this? Yes, okay. And once the plugin has been successfully installed, as we did in the previous examples, I'm going to click on Activate Plugin to activate this plugin. Once we've installed and activated the three plugins recommended by StudioPress, namely the Genesis eNews Extended plugin, the Genesis Responsive Slider plugin, and the Regenerate Thumbnails plugin, there's four more plugins that I'm going to be adding to my WordPress website for this particular website. The first one is Contact Form 7, which is a contact form, so anyone can easily connect with you, send you a note from within your website. So in a moment, we'll be adding Contact Form 7. I'm also going to be adding Reveal IDs to give us the ID numbers of our content, and I'll show you how that works in just a moment. We're also going to be adding a really great email opt-in form that makes it really easy to capture leads on our website, and that's called Magic Action Box. And finally, we're going to be adding the WP Gallery custom links. I'll go over each of these plugins one by one in the video, but for now, we're just going to add these plugins to our website, starting with Contact Form 7. So going back to our plugins page here, I'm going to click on Add New to add this plugin. Then I'm going to do a search for Contact Form 7 and click on Search Plugins. Here it is at the top. I'm just going to click on Install Now to install the Contact Form 7 plugin. Are you sure you want to install this? Yes, okay. And once the plugin has been successfully installed, I'm going to click on Activate Plugin to activate the plugin. The next plugin we need to add is Reveal IDs. So once again, I'm going to click on Add New to add a new plugin. I'm going to do a search for Reveal IDs. and then click on the search button right here. Here we see it's at the top, reveal IDs, so I'm going to click on install now. Then, are you sure you want to install this? Yes, okay. And once it has been successfully installed, I'm going to click on the activate plugin link to activate the plugin. Next, we have the magic action box, so I'm going to click on add new. I'm going to do a search for magic action box right here, and then I'm going to click on search plugins. We're getting the hang of this. Here it is at the top. I'm going to click on install now. Are you sure you want to install this? Yes, okay. And once it has been installed, I'm going to activate it by clicking on activate plugin. Finally, the fourth and last one that I'm going to be adding at this time is the WP Gallery Custom Links plugin. So I'm going to click on add new. Then I'm going to do a search for this by just adding it in right here, WP Gallery Custom Links. And then I'm going to click on search plugins to search for this plugin. Here it is at the top, WP Gallery Custom Links. I'm going to click on install now to install this plugin. Are you sure you want to install this? Yes, okay. And once it has been installed, once again, I'm going to click on activate plugin to activate the plugin. Again, I'll go over all these different plugins one by one as we add them to our site, but it's good to add them, install them, and activate them at least right now. Okay, at the top, we do have a note here. If you're using Gravity Forms, you can check this message out here. I'm not going to be using Gravity Forms because instead I'm using the free Contact Form 7 plugin for my contact form. So you can feel free to check this out though by clicking on this link to create action box right here. I also have the Magic Action Box installed, so I'm also not going to be using Gravity Forms because I'm going to be using this free action box email opt-in form creator using Magic Action Box. So I'm going to hide this notice altogether by clicking on hide notice. Okay, here we see one more message. It says Jetpack is installed and ready to go. We just need to connect this to WordPress.com, and I'll do that a little bit later in the video. Right now, I want to take a look at what the website looks like by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. So this is what our website looks like now. This is pretty much the bare bones out of the box when you first install the Executive Pro Child theme. This is what it looks like. So clearly we've got quite a bit of work to go. This is where we're headed toward right here. This is the completed website once again. So the next step is let's add our logo as well as our website title and tagline. Also, we'll add a few pages so we can start building out the menu here in the header. So starting with the logo, I'm going to go back to our website here. I'm going to click on dashboard. You can also go directly to the header section by clicking on header and going directly there as well. I'm going to click on dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to appearance and click on header right here. And as we can see on the custom header page, we need to upload an image that is 260 pixels wide and 100 pixels tall. This is the optimal image dimensions for the logo. So I have a logo ready to go. I'm just going to click on choose file. Then I'm going to find my file by just clicking on my images here. And here at the bottom, here's my logo. So I'm just going to highlight that and click on choose. And then once the logo is added right here, then I'm going to click on upload to upload this logo. Okay, so here's my logo. Next, I'm just going to scroll down and click on changes to save my changes. Once my logo has been added to my website, the next step is I want to add a few pages so then we can add some menu items to the menu. So to create a page in WordPress, I'm going to go to the left-hand side here, hover over pages, and click on add new. Here on the add new page screen, the first thing that we need to do is we need to give our new page a title. So I'm just going to call this about. This is going to be my about page. Most likely you're going to also want to have an about page about your business, about your website, about you. So here I just added about in the title, and then here in this box here, I'm going to add some content, both text content and image content. Now I want to point out there's two different tabs here, a visual tab and a text tab. The visual tab is the what you see is what you get mode. The great thing about WordPress is that you do not need to know any code. WordPress will create the code for you, which is really great. So this particular view is very similar to when we write an email or when we're using some kind of word processing system. We can add all the text here in this box in the white part here, and then we can use these icons at the top to format our text. So I want to point out this button right here, this icon. When I click on this, it will give me another row of different icons that we can use to format our text. So this particular tab right here is the behind the scenes view. I'll touch upon that in just a moment. Right now, I just want to add some demo content that I've copied from another step. So I'm just going to copy or add in some text here. So you can add whatever text content you'd like in this white box. And just to demonstrate the formatting features here, I'm going to just highlight this again, just like you would do in an email or in Microsoft Word or some other kind of word processing system. I'm just going to highlight some text and I'm going to bold it right there. And then we can see here visually it's bolded. Now, when I click on the text tab right here by clicking on that, we can see that behind the scenes, WordPress has generated the HTML code to create the formatting, which is really great. So if you're interested in learning HTML a little bit or some code, you can kind of toggle back and forth between the visual tab and the text tab to get a sense for what the code is generating behind the scenes. I prefer to stay in the visual view here, so it's like the what you see is what you get view, so I'll just leave it as that. Also, I'm going to unselect this by just highlighting it there and once again clicking the B to unbold this because I really don't want that bolded. I just wanted to show you how that worked. The other thing I want to point out is that the good news is that you don't have to memorize what all these icons do. If you just kind of like hover over them one by one, you'll get this little tooltip and WordPress will tell you exactly what this particular formatting icon does, which is really great. We have our block quotes, left alignment, center alignment, right alignment. We have some insert edit links right here, and you can kind of just go one by one hovering over each of these icons to see what it does. Okay, so now that I have my text in this box right here, the next thing is I want to add an image to my about page. So to do that, I'm going to place the cursor where I want the image to be displayed. So I'm just going to place it right before the W in welcome. Then at the top, I'm going to click on add media to add new media. You can either add media directly from your media library or you can upload a file from your computer. So we don't yet have the images in our media library because I haven't added any yet. So I'm just going to leave it on upload files. Then I'm going to click on select files. Then I'm going to choose the file that I want, which is right here, my pick. Then I'm going to click on choose. And once WordPress has uploaded the image, then you'll see the attachment details here on the right-hand side. Now, it's always a good idea whenever we're adding images to our WordPress website for search engine purposes to give this image a title and an alternative text. So I'll just call this my website name for the moment. So I'll just kind of copy that and paste it in both places. You can also add a caption as well as a description if you'd like. I'm just going to leave it with a title and an alternative text. The alternative text is also helpful for anyone who is visually impaired and who is viewing your website using a text-to-speech software. So they can see or they can tell what the computer will tell them what the image is about by reading what the alternate text is. This is also important for search engine purposes because Google and other search engines cannot really tell what an image is unless we actually give it some data here, some words that it can read what the image is about. So it's always a good idea, once again, to include a title and an alternative text. Once you have those two ready to go, just kind of scroll down. You can choose the alignment if you'd like. I'm going to choose right alignment. You can also link this to a media file, attachment page, a custom URL, or to nothing. I'm not going to link this image to anything, so I'll just leave it as none. And finally, we can choose the size of the image that we'd like to have displayed. So I'll choose the medium size right here, 257 by 300, that sounds good. And then I'm going to click insert into page to insert this into my page. Okay, so here we have my about page. You can also, looking on the right-hand side are the page attributes. If you'd like to create a parent page or use one of the templates that comes with this theme, you can choose that. I'm not going to change anything here. I'm going to go with the default template. I'm going to not touch this. This will actually be the parent page, not a child page. So I'll just leave it just like that. Then I'm going to scroll down. Everything else looks pretty good. I'm not going to really touch anything else. Leave that as it is. We'll come back to the magic action box later in the video. Okay, so right now I'm just going to click on publish to publish this page. Once a page has been published, you can check it out by clicking on View Page. And actually, before I do that, I want to point out one more thing here on this page. When I scroll down, note that there are some theme SEO settings. This is a really important piece to fill out, including your document title, the meta description, and any keywords that you want specifically for this page. So if you're not using any other kind of SEO plugin, then the good news is that this is all built in right within the child theme. The other good news is that if you do choose to use a plugin like the WordPress SEO by Yoast plugin, then this theme is smart enough to know to deactivate the theme SEO settings in order to prioritize the SEO settings in your plugin. So whichever one you use, whether you use an SEO plugin or use the built-in SEO settings right here, you're good to go. So I'm going to I just wanted to point that out for SEO purposes. I'm going to come back up here and I want to check out the page that we've just published by clicking on View Page. So here we see, here's our page so far. We still need to add our widget area here as well as a number of different other pages. So let's add the other pages right now, including a contact page and the blog index page. So to add a contact page, I'm going to come up to the top, hover over plus new, and click on Page. Here where it says add new page, I'm going to make this the blog archive page. So I'm just going to add in blog right there. Then I'm going to leave everything blank. And here where it says page attributes, I'm going to choose the blog template. So I'm just going to click on this right here. Then you'll get a drop down box and I'm going to select blog to use the blog template. Then I'm going to click on publish to publish the blog page. Now we can see when I click on View Page, this is our blog archive page, there's one blog post that comes with your WordPress installation, and we can see that right here. We eventually will be deleting this page and adding some real blog posts, but for the moment, we can see this is our blog archive page. Okay, the next one that I want to add, the next page is the contact page. So I'm going to go back up to the dashboard by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to Plugins and click on Installed Plugins. And then here we can see the Contact Form 7 plugin, which we've added to our WordPress website. So I'm going to click on Settings right here. And here we can see there's an automatic form that comes when you install Contact Form 7, and we can check it out by clicking on Edit. And here we can see this is what the form looks like by default. So you'll have your name, an email field, a subject field, a message field, and a submit button. These are pretty traditional fields for contact forms, so I'm not going to change any of them. You also want to make sure when you scroll down that you have the proper email right here so that the contact form message is sent to the proper email. So this is always a good thing to double check. Then you just want to come up here and we want to highlight this short code. So I'm just going to highlight all of it and copy it. Then I'm going to come up to the top here, hover over plus new, and click on Page to create a new page. Here for this new page, I'm going to call this Contact, since this is my contact page. And here in this white box, I'm going to click on the Text tab because we're going to be adding short code to this particular page. So it's important to make sure that you have clicked on Text right here to go to the Text tab. And then I'm going to paste in the short code that I just copied in the previous step. Next, I'm going to come over to the page attributes. I'm going to leave it as default template, so I'm not going to change anything here. Then I'm going to scroll down and everything else looks good to go. Now, the one thing is this is a contact form, so I do not want to have any comments or discussion on this particular page. So I'm going to click on Screen Options right here. Then I'm going to click on the discussion box. And then when I scroll down below, now we'll see our discussion features right here. And I'm going to turn off comments and turn off trackbacks and pingbacks on this page. I prefer to have comments on my blog posts, not on my pages. So I'm just going to turn these off right here. Then I'm going to scroll to the top and I'm going to click on Publish to publish my new contact page. Okay, so once the contact page has been published, I'm going to click on View Page to view the page. And here we can see the contact page right here. Now note that I just have the contact form here, and it would be really nice to have at least some kind of welcome or welcome message above the form. So I'm going to edit this page really quickly by clicking on Edit Page. Then I'm just going to add a couple sentences right above the form. So I'm just going to add some sentences in there. Thanks for stopping by. I'd love to hear from you. Feel free to reach me on Twitter or just fill out the form below and I'll get back to you right away. So when I click on the visual tab, here is the what you see is what you get view. And I do want to point out that I want to create a link to my Twitter page so that if anyone wants to contact me as well via Twitter, then this link is really easy for them to find. So in order to create a link, we're just going to highlight this word that we want to link right here, highlight it, and then I'm going to click on this link here that says insert edit link, and then I'm going to add the link to my Twitter page right here. Now, whenever I'm sending anyone away from my website, I always click on this link as well that says open link in a new window or tab, because that way, whomever is going to another page away from my website, they'll still have my website open as well. So they'll have two pages open. So it's a good way to give everyone an easy way to come back to your site when you send them away to another page via a link. Once you have all of the destination URLs filled out right here, go ahead and click on add link to add the link. Then I'm going to update the page by clicking on update. Once the contact form has been updated, now we have enough pages to start creating a menu. So to create a menu for the header, I'm going to go to the left-hand side, hover over appearance, and click on menus. Here on the menu screen, we can create a new menu by adding a menu name. So I'll just call this menu and then I'll click on create menu. And then once we have our menu created, now we can start adding some items to the menu. So I'm going to add the contact form, the blog, and the about page by just clicking on these pages right here. Then I'm going to add them to the menu by clicking on the add to menu button. And here we can see now they all show up in my menu right here. To reorganize them and resort them so that they are in the right order that you'd like, I'm just going to drag them around. So for example, I want the about page to be first, then I want the blog page to come up second, and then I want the contact page. I also want to add a home page link. So to do that, I'm going to come over here to links, click on this caret to open up the box, and then I'm going to add my home page right here, and I'm going to give it the link text of home. So here is the URL for the homepage, and here is the text for the menu item, and then I'm going to click on add to menu to add this item to the menu. Once again, I'm going to reorganize this by dragging this one to the top because I want the home link to show up first. Once you have the menu the way you'd like it to be, then go ahead and click on save menu to save your menu. Once you click on Save Menu, then you'll note you have another tab over here that says Manage Locations. So I'm going to click on this right here. We need to set the menu. Now, this particular theme, the Executive Pro Child theme, supports two menus. I'm going to show you both of these just to show you how these are displayed, but we are not actually going to be using either one of them for this particular video, but I do want to show you where they'll show up. So for the moment, I'm just going to click on Menu right here to set the primary navigation menu as the menu we just created. And I'll also, just for demo purposes, I'm going to add the secondary navigation menu as well. So I'm going to add those right there. Then I'm going to click on Save Changes to save the changes. So now that the locations have been added, let's take a look at the homepage to see where they are displayed. So I'm going to go back to the website title at the top and click on Visit Site. And here we can see this is the primary menu navigation area right here. And here's the secondary menu navigation area right here. So this particular theme, once again, supports two menu locations. One here and one here. The other menu location is located in the header over here on the right-hand side, and that is the one that we're going to be using. So I just wanted to show you where this is displayed in the event that you do want to use these, but I'm going to be deleting these right now. So I'm going to go back to the menu by hovering over the website name and going directly to the menus page right here. Then under menu locations, I'm going to click on that. And for primary navigation menu, I'm going to click on select a menu so that there's really nothing set here. And I'm going to do the same for the secondary navigation menu. So we can see here, I've just set both of these menus as select a menu. Then I'm going to click on save changes to save my changes. Now when I go back to my menu by clicking on visit site, now we see that none of these menus are being displayed, which is exactly how I want it to be. So to set the menu instead, the other option, I'm going to go to dashboard once again, then I'm going to scroll down to appearance, hover over appearance, and click on widgets. Here where it says header right, this is where I want to add my custom menu. So I'm going to use this widget called custom menu. I'm going to drag it to my widget area right here. And then here we see I'm going to select the menu that I want, which is menu. I am not going to give this a title. I'm going to leave that blank. And then I'm going to click on save to save my menu. Now when we go back to the homepage by going up to the top and clicking on visit site, now we can see I have a really cool menu right here on the right hand side, and it saves a lot of space because it's not really pushing the website down, the content down, to make room for the menu. The menu is on the same row as the logo, which is how I prefer it to be. So that looks good. We'll change the styles and the size of this so we can see it a little bit later. Let's continue building out the website. So the next thing that I want to add to the homepage is the responsive slider. So what we're going toward is this slider right here, where we'll have some text on the left-hand side or on the right-hand side. I'll show you both options. And then we'll have an image, and there will be this rotation of images in the slider. So to add the slider to our homepage, I'm going to go back to the website and click on dashboard. There's a number of different ways to do this. So we can either create post sliders, page sliders, or portfolio sliders. I'll show you each of those. So I'm going to start by creating a post. So I'm just going to hover over post here and click on add new to create a new blog post. And this post is going to be included in my slider on the homepage. So I'm going to feature the post on the homepage in the slider. So this one, I'm going to add a couple different food related ones. So the first one that we're going to add here is a broccoli post. And then I'm also going to add one related to sprouts, since this is my hypothetical business website related to food, life, and photography. So food is kind of the central focus of this particular website. So going back to my post page, I'm going to start by giving my new post a title. So I'm just going to give it this title right here, upcoming best ways to cook broccoli. So you can feature either an upcoming event or an upcoming course or class, or perhaps even a video or a blog post. So this is going to be the title of my post. Then I'm going to add an image here. So I'm going to click on add media. Then I'm going to click on upload files and select files. And then I'm going to choose my file. It's right here. So just highlight it and click on choose. Then as we did previously, it's always a good idea to include a title as well as an alternative text. So I'm just going to add that in right here. And then I'll give it the alternative text. Once you have those two pieces of data in there, scroll down, and then we can decide on what we want for attachment display settings. So I want to center align this, so I'll leave that at center. I want to link this to nothing, so I'm going to click on none. And then I do want to include the full size, which for this right now, this particular image happens to be 590 pixels wide and 590 pixels tall. You may see something different. This is what I have right here. So I'm going to leave it at that. Then I'm going to click on insert into post to insert this into my post. Once the image has been added, here we can see that we're in the text view, which is why we see the HTML code behind the scenes. To see the visual view, I'm going to click on visual right here, and then we see our image. Next, on the right-hand side, we can give this a category. So to create a new category, I'm going to click on this link that says add new category. I'm going to call this food, and then I'm going to click on the button one more time to actually add the new category. We can also add some tags to this post. So I will call this broccoli, and then I'll also call it class. And then I will click on add. Note that between the two words, you want to actually place a comma to separate the two different tags. So once you have your tags in here, go ahead and click on add to add the new tags. Also, I'm going to come back to this post actually. I do want to add some content text after this. So it's a little bit large of an image right here. So it's a little bit hard to get to the line underneath the image. So the best way to do that is to click on text right here, and then you can place your carriage return or your cursor a little bit lower than the image, and then you can paste in or add in any kind of text that you'd like. So I'll just add some text right there. Join us for our next cooking class. We'll be creating gourmet dishes that can be included in your next dinner party. Sign up today. So I'll just add that text right there. Then I'm going to scroll down. You can add some theme SEO settings here if you'd like. Then I'm going to scroll down a little bit further, and then here where it says excerpt, actually I don't see excerpt here, so we need to add that. So this is an important part. So here at the top, there's this button here that says screen options. I'm going to click on this, and then there's this box here that says excerpt. So we need that in order to create the text on the left-hand side of the slider. So I just clicked on excerpt right there. Now when I scroll down, I should see the excerpt field options. So here it is right here, and here I'm going to add the text that I want to have displayed in the slider on the left or right hand side. So I just added some short text right there. Then I'm going to come up to the top here, and the last part here for this process is we need to add a featured image that will actually be displayed in the slider. So to set the featured image, I'm going to click on Set Featured Image. Then I'm going to add an image to this particular area right here. So I'm going to click on Upload Files. Then I'm going to click on Select Files. Here is the image that I need, just called broccoli. Then I'm going to click on Choose. And once again, WordPress will upload the image to my media library. Now note that the image dimensions for the slider are really specific. You need to make sure that the image dimensions for the slider are 1140 pixels wide and 445 pixels tall. These are the best image dimensions for the slider. So I'll be sure to make a note of this because this is a pretty important detail related to the slider to make sure that it displays well. Once you have the image uploaded, then once again, you can give your image a title and an alternative text. Okay, so I have the title and the alternative text set. Then I'm going to scroll down and I'm going to click on Set Featured Image to set the featured image. Then I'm going to come up to the top and click on Publish to publish my new post. So to check out the post, we can click on View Post right here. And here we see this is our new blog post. Now we haven't yet added it to the slider on the homepage, but at least we can see what the post itself looks like. So it's pretty basic. We have some more features that we'll add later on in the video, but for now it looks okay. So let's add one more post so that we can include it in our slider. So once again, I'm going to go up to the top, hover over plus new, and click on post. Next here on my add new post screen, the first thing that I need to do is give my new post a title. So I'm just going to add a post title right in there. Next here in the white content box, I need to add some content, either an image, text, or a video. I'm going to add an image as well as some text. So once again, I'm going to click on add media, then I'll click on upload files, and then select files, and then I need to find the file that I need, which is right here, and click on choose. Once WordPress uploads the image to my website, then once again, I can add a title as well as an alternative text. So I'll just add that in right there. And then I'm going to scroll down. I'm going to center align this as well. I'm going to link this to nothing. So I'll click on none. And once again, I'm going to include the full size right here, which this happens to be 590 by 590. So 590 pixels wide and 590 pixels tall. Okay, once you have the display settings set, then click on Insert into Post to insert your image into the post. So here we can see the code for this particular image. I'm also going to add some text right here. So I'm just going to place the cursor two rows down, and then I'm going to paste some text. Once you have your image and your text added here in the content box, and also note we're in the text view, so when I click on visual, then we'll see the actual what you see is what you get view, which is right here. So that looks good. Then on the right hand side, I'm going to add this as well to the food category. So I'm just going to click on the box right there. I'm going to add some tags right here as well. So I'll call this sprouts and superfood. And perhaps I'll also add some tips right there. And then I'm going to click on add to add these tags to the post. Once again, here are the theme SEO settings, so you want to make sure that you add this right here. Again, this is if you're not using an SEO plugin. If you're using an SEO plugin, then you can just kind of ignore this. If you're not using an SEO plugin, it's a good idea to fill out the SEO settings right here. Next, I'm going to add a featured image. So I'm going to click on Set Featured Image and then Upload Files. Then select files, and here are the sprouts right there. So I'm going to select my file and click on choose. Once again, the image dimensions for the slider are 1140 pixels wide and 445 pixels tall, as we can see right here on the right-hand side under attachment details. So I'm going to give this a title and an alternative text right here, and then I'm going to scroll down. Everything looks good. I'm going to click on Set Featured Image to set the featured image. Finally, I'm going to scroll down below, and in the excerpt field, I'm going to add some text that I'd like to have displayed in the box on the left-hand side or the right-hand side of the slider. Once you have the excerpt added right here, then we can come up to the top and we can click on Publish to publish our new blog post. Once a post has been published, we can check it out again by clicking on View Post. And here we see we have our post title, we have our image, we have some content right here, and then the rest of the post, the comments. Okay, so the next step is we need to actually add these two posts to the responsive slider on the homepage. So here we see when I go to the homepage by clicking on home, the default display for this particular theme is pretty much all the different blog posts on the homepage. Of course, we're going to change that by setting up the different sections of the homepage, but if we don't do anything, this is what it would look like. It would just be like all the different blog posts displaying one after the other on the homepage. So let's go ahead and add the responsive slider now to the homepage by going up to the top, clicking on Dashboard. Next, we'll go to Appearance, hover over Appearance, and click on Widgets. Next, we can see there's a number of different widget areas, especially some widget areas specifically related to the homepage. We have the Home Slider widget, the Home Top widget. There's a Home Call to Action widget and a Home Middle section right here. So the one that we want is the Home Slider. So I'm just going to open that up by clicking on this little caret here. Then we can see there's a number of different Genesis slider widgets here. Let's see, where is it? Right here, Genesis responsive slider. So this is the one that we want. So it displays a slideshow inside a widget area. So I'm just going to drag that into this little widget section right here and release it. Then I'm going to click on save to save this in this widget. Next, we can see it says to configure the slider options, please go to the slider settings page and there's a link. So I'm going to click on this link right here to go to the slider settings. And here we can see we have the settings for the Genesis responsive slider. Also note that you can also get to this page on the left-hand side by hovering over Genesis and clicking on slider settings. So there's a number of different ways in WordPress to reach the same page. So here at the top, we can decide what kind of content we want to have displayed. We could choose either a post, a page, or a portfolio. I've so far created some posts with the slider images, so I'm going to be using the post content right here, but you can choose also a page or a portfolio as well. If you choose the page or the portfolio, you would set them up in a very similar way to the way that we set up the post slider right here. Keeping in mind that the dimensions of the image are 1140 pixels wide and 445 pixels tall. Okay, so I'm going to leave it as post. Then you can choose what term you would like to include, if any. I'm just going to leave it as all. Next, we can include or exclude by taxonomy ID. This field will come in handy if you decide to customize the taxonomy or terms up above. So again, I'm not going to be using taxonomies or terms for my responsive sliders. I'm actually going to be using post. So coming down below here where it says include or exclude by post IDs, I want to select include, and then I need to add the post IDs to be displayed. So in order to find the post IDs, we need to actually go back to the post page. So I'm going to click on include right here, and then I'm going to save my settings by clicking on save settings. We'll come back to this in just a moment. So going back to my post page, I'm going to click on post right here. And this is where the Reveal IDs plugin, which we added to the website earlier in the video, comes in handy. With the Reveal IDs plugin, it will give us some ID numbers here on the right hand side, which we can include in our responsive slider settings. So the ID number that I want is 543 and 535. Of course, keep in mind that the ID number for your post, portfolio, or page will be different, so be sure to add your page, post, or portfolio ID number instead. So making a note of these two ID numbers, now I'm going to go back to my slider settings by going to Genesis on the left-hand side and then clicking on slider settings. Then I can scroll down to the post IDs and I can list which post IDs I want to include. So here I have, once again, I have include selected right here, and then I would add the two ID numbers for the two posts that I want to include that I want to have featured in the responsive slider. So those ID numbers include 543 and 535. Next, I can choose the number of sliders to show, and I only have two sliders, so I'll just make this two right here. Then I'm just going to scroll down. There's some other settings. If you want to change the transition time settings, you can do so. I'm not going to do that. I'll just keep all the defaults in right here. Next, we can see the display settings are listed right here, and you want to make sure that this says 1140 in the first box for width and 445 pixels high or height in the second box right here. So these are the display settings that we want for the slider. If you'd like to include or not include the next and previous arrows on the slider, you can either turn them off or on. I'll leave them on. I'll also leave the display pagination in the slider, but this is optional if you want to turn that off. Next, we can scroll down and you can have more settings here if you want to decide how to customize your content settings. I'm going to leave all of these default settings set right here. You can also change the more text if you like, so I'll just call this learn more instead of continue reading. Next, we have the slider width. So there's a box on the slider, so when I go to the actual finished result, this is the completed view of the website when the website is all finished, and we can see here we have the width dimension of this box, and right now it's being displayed on the left-hand side. So going back to our slider settings, if you want to reduce the width of that box, you can change that here. Also, if you want to change the excerpt location, you can either place it at the top or the bottom. That would be the words that show up in that box. And then finally, that box right now is being displayed on the left-hand side by default, but if you want it to be displayed on the right-hand side of the slider, you can set it to right instead. I'll leave it as left. So when you have all the settings set for the slider, go ahead and click on Save Settings to save your slider settings. Now when we take a look at the home page by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site, now we see here we have the slider showing up right here. We have the box on the left-hand side and then our image right here. Also, we can see this is kind of going a little bit fast, so if I want to slow that down, I can go back to the slider settings by clicking on Dashboard. Then I can go down to Genesis and click on Slider Settings. And to slow down the slider transition between sliders, I can just go to Time Between Slides right here, and I'll just make it 10,000. Once you've set the time between the slides as you like it, go ahead once again and click on Save Settings to save the settings. So now when I go back up to my slide by clicking on Visit Site, now we can see it's going to slide or transition a lot slower, which is a lot easier to read on the eye. Also note, if you want to change this box to put it on the right-hand side. Once again, I'm going to go up to the top, click on Dashboard, go to Genesis, click on Slider Settings, scroll down. I'm going to click it on right this time in Excerpt Location and click on Save Settings. Then when I come up to the top and click on Visit Site, now it's on the right-hand side. You can also remove this box altogether if you don't want to see it, if you just want one super wide image. Perhaps you want to include some words on your image itself without the box. You could put your call to action directly within the image. And so to remove this box altogether, we would go up to the top, click on dashboard. Then we can go to Genesis, click on slider settings, scroll to the bottom, and then here where it says display content in slider, I would uncheck that. I would also uncheck display page or post in slider. And most importantly, right here, this is where we can remove the box altogether, and we would simply make this a zero. So by making the width of the excerpt zero, like so, and then clicking on save settings, that will remove the box altogether. So when we go up to the website by clicking on visit site, now we'll simply have the image. So it's really up to you. There's so many different ways to customize this slider. So whatever your preference is, you can have three different options to customize this how you'd like. I like having the excerpt box on the left-hand side with the calls to action. So I'm going to add that back right now by going to dashboard, then going to Genesis and clicking on slider settings, scrolling down, and I'm going to add this width back in again as 30 and display the page title and the page slider right here. And then I'm going to click on save settings to restore my settings for my slider. So now when I come back up to the top, hover over the website name and click on visit site, now we see that, oh, it's on the right hand side. I want it on the left hand side. So sorry, I'm going to go back dashboard. Then I'm going to click on Genesis and slider settings. We're getting the hang of this. This is good practice. And then I'm going to put it on the left hand side right here where it says excerpt location and click on save settings. So once we have the settings for the slider set up, I'm going to click on visit site. Here we have our slider set up. The next thing is we want to add some more content on the homepage below the slider, including the call to action box and the different widget areas. So to do that, I'm going to go back to the widget areas by clicking on, actually you can hover over the website name and go directly to widgets by clicking on widgets right here. And here we are on the widgets page. So we've already added a home slider widget to the home page. The other widgets we can add to the home page include a home top section widget, a home call to action widget, and a home middle section widget. In this video, I'm going to be adding two of these, namely the call to action widget and the middle section widget. So as an example of what this is going to look like, when I go back to the completed demo right here, this website that's already been completed, and we scroll down underneath the slider here, we have the first widget that I'm going to be adding, which is a call to action widget. I'm actually going to be adding an email opt-in form here, but we can also add another call to action kind of widget here with a button and then some kind of like content. So I'll show you both different kinds of calls to action that you can add in this widget section right here. The other widget section that I'm going to be adding is this middle section here, and I'm going to be adding three different images, each of which link to a different page on the website, namely a learn page, a shop page, and a hire me page. So in order to create this widget section, we actually need to first create the pages for this because I haven't yet created these pages. So let's go ahead and create on our website these three different pages. So going back to my website right here, I'm going to create the first page by going up to the top, hovering over plus new and clicking on page. Then here, the first thing that I want to do is give my new page a title. So I'll just call this learn. Next, in the content box, I'm going to be adding a video. So to add a video is really easy in WordPress. All we need to do is go to YouTube. So I'm going to go to YouTube over here. And then here on YouTube, all we need to do is grab the URL of the video. So I'm just going to highlight this URL right here and copy it. Then I'm going to go back to my website right here. I'm in the visual tab and I'm just going to paste in the video URL like that. So it's really simple in WordPress in order to add a video to your website, whether it's a page or a post. You just simply add the URL of the YouTube video or the Vimeo video right here in the content box. That's it. Okay, so then scrolling down, what kind of template do we want? When I click on this, we have these different options right here, and I think I'm going to keep it with just the default template, so I'll leave it like that. You can also add some theme SEO settings if you'd like, and then here we can add our featured image. So this is what we'll need in order to create this effect here with the image being displayed within the widget section. So to add the featured image, I'm just going to click on set featured image. Then I'm going to click on upload files and select files. Then I'm going to select the image that I want, which is this one right here that says learn, and then I'm going to click on choose. And then once WordPress has uploaded the image to my website, then once again, I can just give this a title. I'll just call it learn. and I'll give this an alternative text. I'm going to scroll down and then I'm going to click on this button here that says set featured image to set the featured image. Once the image has been set, then I'm also going to scroll down and you notice that here are some different layouts. So by default, we have, I believe, the sidebar showing up on the right hand side, but if you want the sidebar to show up on the left hand side, or if you want a full width with no sidebar, these are the layout settings that you can choose right here for the page. I'm going to leave it with the default layout, which I believe is a right hand sidebar. So you can check out what the default is by clicking on theme settings. I'm pretty sure it's on the right hand side though, and that's what I want. So I'm going to keep it like that. And then I'm going to scroll down. I'm also going to turn off discussion because I prefer discussion and comments to be on my blog posts, not on my pages. So it's really up to you. This is optional, but I'm going to uncheck this so there's no comments on my page. And then I'm going to scroll up and click on publish to publish my new page. Okay, so once a learn page has been created, the next page that I want to create is a shop page with a photo gallery. So I'm going to click on add new to add a new page. This time I'm going to call it shop. You could also just call it photos or photo gallery. I'm going to show you how we can add some affiliate links here. So for that reason, I'll call it shop, but this could easily be a photo gallery, a simple photo gallery as well. So I'm just going to add the cursor right here where I want to add the photo gallery. Then I'm going to click on add media to add my media, and I need to upload some files. So I'm going to click on upload files and then select files. And then the files that I want to create are right here in this untitled folder. So I'm just going to choose them all at the same time. I'm going to highlight all of them and click on choose, and WordPress will add all of them to the media gallery all at once, which is really great. As we've done with all of the images so far, it's a really good idea to add a title and an alternative text. So I'm going to do that as well. Okay, so I've added a title and alternative text to each of the images that I want to feature in my photo gallery, but the other thing that I also want to add is a caption, because I want the caption to be displayed underneath each of the images in my photo gallery. So to add the caption is really simple. I'm just going to call it the same as a title. So I'll just copy this and add the caption right in here. And I'm going to do this for each of the different images that I'm going to feature in my photo gallery. Once we have the caption added to each of the images, the next step is we need to create a gallery. And here on the left-hand side, underneath where it says insert media, there's a link here to create a gallery. So this is the link that we need to click. So I'm going to click on create gallery. Then I'm going to choose the images that I want in my gallery. So I'm just going to select them one by one. So I want this one, this one, this one, this one, and finally these two right here. Once you have the images selected for your gallery, the next step is to click on this button here that says create a new gallery. Then we can edit the gallery. So if you want to move some of the images around, you can just drag them into the order that you'd like to see each of the images displayed. Okay, once you have the images displayed in the order that you'd like, here on the right-hand side, you can choose where you want this to link to, either to an attachment page, a media file, or none. And you can also choose the number of columns that you'd like to have displayed. So I'm going to choose 3 columns right now. We're going to come back to these settings right here because we need to add the Jetpack plugin with the carousel settings, and that is going to provide us with some additional options. So right now, for the moment, I'm not going to really change these right there. I'll just leave these as they are. We'll come back to these in just a moment. I'm going to click on insert gallery to insert the gallery. Then here on the right-hand side, I'm going to scroll down. I'm going to leave it as the default template right here. So I'm just going to leave it as default template. Then scrolling down, once again, you can add the theme SEO settings. And then here where it says layout settings, this time I do not want to have a right sidebar or a left sidebar. I actually want to have no sidebar because I want to just have the photo gallery displayed on its own. So I'm going to click this full width layout right here. Then scrolling down, I'm going to turn off the comments because I don't want any comments on this page. So I'm just going to uncheck these two boxes right there. And then finally, up here where it says featured image, we need to set the featured image. So I'm going to click on set featured image, and then I'm going to upload a file by clicking on upload file and select files. And this time the image that I want is called shop. So I'm just going to click on this image that I'd like, and then I'm going to click on choose. Also note that the dimensions of this particular image that I'm using are 300 pixels wide and 150 pixels tall. So those are the image dimensions that I'm using for this particular widget featured image. So I'm going to give this a title, I'll just call it shop, and I'll give it an alternative text. And then I'm going to scroll down and click on this button to set the featured image. Next, I'm going to scroll up to the top here and click on publish to publish the image and the entire page. Okay, so we have our two pages set. The last page that I want to create is the Hire Me page. So once again, we need to create that page. So I'm going to come up to the top, click on plus new, and then click on page. And I'll just call this services. These will be like the services that I offer on my business website. So I'm just going to call it services here. I'll add some demo content in here. Then on the right-hand side, I'll leave it as default template. I'm going to add a different featured image this time. So I'm going to click on set featured image and then upload image. And then once again, I'm going to click on select files. And the one that I want this time is called Hire Me. This will be the Hired Me featured image. I'm going to click on choose. Then WordPress will upload the image. This one as well is 300 pixels wide and 150 pixels tall. So I'm going to give it a title as well as an alternative text right here. And then I'm going to click on set featured image to set the featured image. Here we have the theme SEO settings. So you can go ahead and fill in all the different SEO settings right here. And then scrolling down for this one as well, I'm going to leave this as the default layout. This time I will include the right-hand sidebar, so I'll just leave it with default settings right here for the layout. Then finally, scrolling down, I'm going to turn off the discussion by unchecking these two boxes in the discussion section right here. Okay, so once we have that all ready to go, I'm going to click on publish to publish this new page. Okay, so once the three pages have been created, now we can add them to the home page in the middle widget section. So to add those widgets on the home page, I'm going to go back to the appearance area. So I'm going to hover over appearance and click on widgets. Next here where it says call to action, I'm going to open this box right here and I'm going to add some temporary placeholders for that. So I'm just going to scroll down. I'm going to grab this text widget here and I'm going to drag that to the call to action widget. So I'm just going to drop this text widget right here in the call to action widget area right here. And then we'll come back to this. Right now, this is just a placeholder. So I'm going to collapse that by clicking on this box. And then here where it says home middle, I'm going to open up this particular widget area and I'm going to add the Genesis featured page widget. So I'm just going to drag this over to the middle section right here. Next here in the Genesis featured page widget settings, we can set the page that we want to have featured. So here it says page, so I'm going to click on that, and we have all these different pages that we've added to our website so far. The one that I want to have featured first is the learn page, so I'm going to click on learn. You can also add a written text by typing in a text here in the title field. I'm not going to add a title because I actually have the word learn on the image, so I'll just keep it with the image. And to show the featured image, I need to click on this box right here that says show featured image. Next, we can choose the image size that we'd like to have displayed within that widget section. And so when I click on this, we have four different options to choose from with all the different dimensions mentioned. So I'm going to choose thumbnail, the thumbnail image right here. We're actually going to change these image dimensions in just a moment, but for the moment right now, I'm going to leave it at thumbnail 150 by 150. This is definitely not the image dimensions that we need though. If you recall, the image that I uploaded was 300 pixels wide and 150 pixels tall. So we're going to have to change that. Next, the image alignment, I'm going to choose, I'll just leave it as none because it's going to take up the whole section anyway. If you'd like to show page content or create a character limit, you can add that here. And if you want to add more text or put more text, like read more, continue reading, you can add whatever words you want to feature right here. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to add any text because the text is really included in the image and that keeps it really clean and really simple. So I'm going to keep it simple and clean for this particular widget. Next, I'm going to click on save to save the settings, and then I'm going to collapse the box by clicking on this caret to close the box. Now I'm going to add two more of these widgets because I want three of them to be displayed in the row. So I'm just going to come over here. hover over the Genesis featured page right here. And once again, I'm going to drag it to the home middle widget area. And I'm also going to add a third one right here by dragging that over right here. And then once again, I'm going to set the image that, I'm going to set the page that I want in the second featured page widget. So the second one that I want right here is the shop page. So I'm going to click on shop. Again, I'm going to click on the show featured image. I'm going to leave it at thumbnail 150 by 150. This one also will be changed in just a moment. Then I'm going to click on save. Finally, the third one right here is the third page that I want to have featured on the home page, and that is the Hire Me page, which it looks like right now it's called Services. So it looks like I need to go back and change the title of this page from Services to Hire Me. So I'll be sure to do that in just a moment as well. Then I'm going to show the featured image. So I'm going to click on this box right here that says Show Featured Image. And then finally at the bottom, I'm going to click on Save to save the settings of this widget. So now when we go to the home page, I'm going to go up to the top, hover over the website name and click on Visit Site. And here we can see the beginning of our home page starting to kind of flesh out. So this black thick bar right here is the call to action widget, which we haven't set up yet. So we still need to add some content in there, but that's okay. It's a placeholder right now. And then here we have these three widgets being displayed in the middle home page widget section. Now note that they're quite short. So our next step is we need to regenerate the thumbnails and change the thumbnail image dimensions for these particular images right here. So let's do that next. We're going to change the thumbnail image dimensions on the homepage for these widgets. To change the thumbnail image dimensions, I'm going to go up to the top, click on Dashboard, then I'm going to go down to Settings, hover over Settings and click on Media. So note that right now the current thumbnail size is 150 by 150 and that's why those images, which should be 300 pixels wide, are showing up as only 150 pixels. So we need to change that. So I'm going to change this from 150 to 300. Just like that. I'm going to leave the height right now for the moment as 150 because again, the images for those particular widget sections, they are 300 pixels wide and 150 pixels tall. So if you have different image dimensions, then by all means change the dimensions to whatever fits the images that you're using. I'm using 300 by 150, so I'm going to set it as that, and then I'm going to click on Save Changes to save my changes. We're not done yet. Once we've changed the actual thumbnail size dimensions, we need to regenerate our thumbnails. So to regenerate thumbnails, I'm going to go to the Media section here, click on Media. Then I'm going to select the three images that are the featured images on the homepage. So it's the Hire Me button here, the Shop button, and there should be another one down here that says Learn. There we go. So those are the three that I want to regenerate the thumbnails for. So I'm going to do these all at once by clicking on the Bulk Actions button right here. So I'm going to click on that. Then when I click on that, I have a Regenerate Thumbnails option right here. So I'm going to click on Regenerate Thumbnails, and then finally, I'm going to complete the process by clicking on Apply to regenerate all three of those images all at once. Okay, now that those have all been successfully resized, we can go back to the home page by hovering over the website name and clicking on Visit Site. And now when I scroll down, these look so much better. They're exactly the right dimension that they need to be right here, which is perfect. Also note, when I click on each one of these, they should go to each of the respective pages. So when I click on that one, I go to the Learn page with my video. And then when I click on the Shop page right here, when I click on Shop, I should go to my portfolio gallery. Now note that we have not yet resized the thumbnails for these six images, so that is the next thing that we should do because these are pretty small right here. So I want to make these larger, maybe like 300 pixels wide and 300 pixels tall because I know that the width of this is about 900 pixels wide. So I'm going to make each of these images 300 by 300. So to do these thumbnails here, I'm going to go back to the top, click on dashboard. Once again, I'm going to go down to settings and then media because I need to change my thumbnail sizes one more time. And instead of 300 by 150, this time I want to make them square. So I'm going to call them 300 by 300. And then I'm going to click on save changes to save my changes. As we did in the previous example, I need to regenerate the thumbnails for those six images. So I'm going to go back to the media settings right here by clicking on media. Then I'm going to select all six of the images that are featured in the photo portfolio page. So I've got three of them right there. There we go, all six of them. And then I'm going to bulk edit them all at once. So once all of the individual items are selected that you want to regenerate the thumbnails for, then here at the top, I'm going to click on bulk actions. Then I'm going to click on regenerate thumbnails. And then I'm going to click on apply to apply that across all six images. Okay, so all done. Six images were successfully resized. So now to check out what that looks like, I'm going to go back to the site by hovering over the website URL name and clicking on visit site. And now when I scroll down and click on shop to go to the shop page, now we see all of my different images are so much bigger. They look so much better. They've got each of their captions under them too, which is really, really great. So when I click on each of these, note when I click on this one, it's going to actually go to the photo image attachment page, which actually I do not want to have happen. I would prefer to have each of these images opening up into a really nice large lightbox display. So in order to do that, we're going to need to activate the Jetpack plugin. So to activate the Jetpack plugin, I'm going to go back to the dashboard by hovering over the website name and clicking on dashboard. Then here at the top, it says Jetpack is installed and ready to go, but we need to connect it to WordPress.com. So if you don't see this message, then you may need to install the Jetpack plugin. And to install Jetpack, you want to go down to plugins, hover over plugins, and then click on installed plugins. So here you can check to see if you've already installed the Jetpack plugin. Here we see I've already installed and activated it. If you need to install it, if you don't see Jetpack in your list right here, then you want to click on Add New and you want to do a search for Jetpack. And then you want to click on Search Plugins. And then when you see this link here at the top for Jetpack, you want to install it and activate it. Once again, I've already installed and activated Jetpack. The last step though is I need to connect it to WordPress.com. So going back to my dashboard right here, I'm going to click on this box right here that says Learn More. And once again, it says Jetpack supercharges your self-hosted WordPress site with the awesome cloud power of WordPress.com. And here I need to connect to WordPress.com in order to activate all of these awesome features. So coming up to the top, I'm going to click on this button to connect to WordPress.com, which brings us to the WordPress.com page. Now, if you already have a WordPress.com account, it's a free account. All you need to do is sign up to get started. If you already have an account, go ahead and add your email and your password and click on sign in. So if you do not have a WordPress.com account, you can click on this link here that says Get Started, which will bring you to the sign up page to sign up for WordPress.com. Now, by default, WordPress will send you to this page where you can add an email address, a username, a password, and a blog address, which we really don't need the blog address because we already have our website that we're creating. Mainly, the only thing we need here is we need a username. So here on the bottom right-hand side, there's a really small little link here that says sign up for just a username. So I'm going to click on this one right here, which will take us to a shortened version of this form where you can simply add your email address, a username, and a password. And then you can click on this button here to sign up for a WordPress.com account. It's a free account. And again, all we need is a username and a password. So I already have an account, so I'm going to sign in. And when I sign in, then it will bring me to this page where I can authorize Jetpack with my WordPress.com account. So I'm going to click on Authorize Jetpack to authorize Jetpack. And once I've authorized Jetpack with WordPress.com, now I can use all these features down below, which is really great. So I'm going to set them all up right now, at least the ones that I need, including starting with comments. I'm going to activate comments right here, Jetpack comments, by clicking on Activate. Next, once the comments have been activated, the other one that I want is the carousel feature right here. This will give us the ability to use a light box on that photo gallery page. So I'm gonna click on activate to activate the Jetpack carousel feature. Next, I'm gonna scroll down. The other features that I want to add are the sharing features right here. So I'm gonna click on configure to set up sharing features. This will enable us to easily give our visitors a way to share our content on the social web, either to Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, email, Google+, or some other social network. So in order to enable these, I'm just going to take the ones that I want and drag them to this enabled services section right here. I'm just going to drag and drop the available services. So I want to add Facebook and I want to add Twitter. I also want to add Google+. And let's see, Pinterest, I'll add Pinterest. And then there's a section over here where we can create a more box. And note down here, here's a live preview of how this will be displayed on our website. So here in this section right here, I'm gonna add Tumblr, and I'll also add LinkedIn, I'll add email, and finally I will add Reddit. You can add the other services if you'd like. I'm just gonna add these for now. And note that here is the display, the way it will display under the blog post or the page if you choose to add these to pages. I'm just gonna add this to my post though. And note that when we come to this one right here, it will actually doesn't look like we can see it, but when we hover over this on the actual website, this will display with all these four additional boxes right here that you can provide the means for anyone to share via these different networks as well. Okay, great. So then down here below, I'm going to show the buttons on my post page. So I'm just going to click on that right there. And then I'm going to click on Save Changes to save my changes. Okay, so all the sharing settings have been saved. Now we can go back to our photo gallery page. So I'm going to go back up to my site to visit the site. Then I'm going to scroll down and click on Shop Now. And now when I click on this particular image right here, I'm going to click on that. Here we see now it will pop up into a really cool light box display, and I can see all of my images in this light box, which is really great. So earlier in the video, I mentioned that I was going to show you three ways to set up this photo gallery. Number one, as a light box display, which is what we have going on right now. Number two, I'm also going to show you how to link each of these images to an internal page within your website. So for example, if you have a product that you want to talk about, you can have each of these images going to a page within your website. And number three, I'm also going to show you how to link each of these images, if you prefer, to your affiliate page via your affiliate link. So for example, if you have some kind of like affiliate program that you're associated with on Amazon.com or some other place, I'm going to show you how to create an affiliate link that links each of the images to the actual affiliate page. So let's start with adding an internal page within our website and linking one of these images to that internal page. So the first thing that I need to do is I need to create an internal page. So I'm going to create an internal blog post, and I'm going to link one of these images to my internal blog post. So I'm going to come up to the top, hover over plus new, and click on post. Then here on my new post page, I'm going to add my post, starting with the title. So I'm going to call this Detox Juice Cleanse. Then here in the content section, I'm going to add my cursor and click on Add Media. Then, let's see, I have this image right here, so I'll choose that in my media library, so I'll just highlight it, and then I will click on Insert into Post. Next, we can add some content related to this if we'd like. It's kind of hard to see it down below, so I'm going to click on Text right here to go to the text view, and here there's more space for me to add some text. So I'm just going to add the cursor return below the image right here, and then I'm going to add some text right here. Now, when I go back to the visual view, and I scroll down, here we can see the demo text that I've added related to this post. On the right hand side, I'm going to choose food, since this is in the food category. I'm going to give it some tags. I'll call this detox and cleanse. And then I will click on add. And then here in theme SEO settings, you can add all of those if you'd like, as well as a featured image. I'm not going to add a featured image for this particular post. I'm going to leave it as is. I'm going to scroll down and everything else looks pretty good. So I'm going to leave it like that. That looks great. Then I'm going to come up here and I'm going to click on publish to publish my new blog post. So once a blog post has been created, now we can view it by clicking on View Post. And here we have the new blog post, which is really great with the different sharing options right here. Okay, so the thing that I need now is I need the URL for this particular post because this is the page that I want that image in the photo gallery to link to. So I'm just going to come up here, grab the URL, I'm going to highlight it and copy it. Then I'm going to go back to my photo gallery page by, let's see, where is it? I'm going to go back to the home page here by clicking on the logo. Scroll down, I'm going to click on the shop page because that is where my photo gallery is. And I'm going to add it to this particular image here. So right now when I click on this, we'll see that it pops open into a Lightbox display. So that's the option that we've already created. The other option is I'm going to create a custom link that goes when I click on this, it will go to that blog post page related to the detox juice cleanse. So to do that, I'm going to click on edit page. Then here on my gallery, I'm going to click on the gallery once to highlight it. And then I have this icon on the left-hand side that says edit gallery. I'm going to click on edit gallery. And here we can see the image that I need, which is this green juice right here. So I'm going to click on that. And we had added previously in the video, we added a plugin called the WordPress Gallery Custom Link Plugin. So that is why now when I scroll down here, we have these extra features where we can add a special custom gallery link for this particular image. So right here where it says gallery link URL, I'm going to add the internal blog post URL right there. You can also choose where you want this to target to, this gallery link. And when I click on this question mark here, it will tell you exactly what this does, whether you want to link with to a same window or a new window. Because this is linking internally within the same website, within my website, I'm going to keep it as same window right there. Next, I'm going to click on Update Gallery to update my gallery. Finally, I'm going to click on Update to update all the settings on this page. So now when we go to View Page by clicking on View Page, when we click on this particular image, it will open up into a Lightbox display. However, when we go to this particular image right here, it's going to send us to that individual blog post internal page within my website. So of course you want to keep it consistent throughout your website. So what you do for one image on your photo gallery page, you should do for all of them. But I want to show you some different variations of where these images can link to within the photo gallery. So going back to the photo gallery, the third option is to link to an external website. So when I click on shop once again, now I want to add one of these. I want to click on one of these and I want to be sent to an external website. So for example, if you have an affiliate link, if you're an affiliate of say Amazon.com or some other website, you can add those products here and you can link directly from your photo gallery directly to your affiliate page with your affiliate link and get credit for that referral. So I'm just going to go to Amazon right here and I'm going to sign in to my Amazon account. So if you don't have an Amazon affiliate account and you'd like to create an Amazon affiliate account, it's a totally optional, but I do get questions about this quite often. So I just want to point it out. You can go to Amazon.com, scroll to the bottom of the page, and then where it says become an affiliate, you can sign up by just clicking on this link to become an affiliate. Once you've created your affiliate account on Amazon.com, you can log in, and then to find the affiliate links, you just want to search for the products within your Amazon Associates account. So looking at my shop page once again, I have a broccoli recipe, for example, right here. So if I wanted to find a product related to broccoli, I know that's super random, but just for the demo purpose here, I'm going to look for a book on broccoli. So I'm just going to put in broccoli and I'll put recipe book here, maybe something like that. Then I'm just going to click on go to find some product on Amazon. And I'll just choose this one right here, 20 broccoli recipes for easy family meals. I'm going to click on this link here to get the link. And then I'm just going to highlight this entire link right there. And then I'm going to go back to my gallery. So here we are on my gallery page. I'm going to click on edit page. Then once again, as we did in the previous example, for an internal link, I'm going to click on the gallery once, then I'm going to click on the Edit Gallery button. And now I'm going to find the broccoli image right here, and I'm going to scroll down, and this time, instead of adding an internal website link to my own website, I'm going to add my affiliate link right here to go to the Amazon website with my affiliate code right there. Then here where it says gallery, link, or target, because we're going to an external website, I actually want to create a new window. That way, anyone who links to this and goes to the Amazon page will still have my website open as well. So they'll have two pages open. That way they can easily get back to my website. Once you have your link, whatever external link you want to add here. It doesn't have to be an affiliate account. It could be anything, really. Then you can just click on Update Gallery to update your gallery. Finally, you want to click on Update here to update the entire page. So once the page has been updated, then we can click on View Page to check it out. And now we should have three different options for all of these links. Again, it's important to keep it consistent, to keep everything consistent. So if you're going to create a lightbox display, I suggest creating a lightbox display for all the images. If you're going to be linking internally within your website, then I suggest doing that for all the images. And if you're going to be creating external links to other pages, it's probably a good idea to do that as well, just for consistency. So it's really up to you, however you want to do it. If you prefer kind of a hodgepodge, that's okay too, but it might confuse your visitors. Okay, so now once again, when I click on this image, it's going to open up into a lightbox display. When I click on the second image here, it's going to go to the product page on Amazon using my affiliate link. And note that when I go back to my page right here, when I click on this particular link, it's going to go to an internal website post page within my website. Okay, so the next thing that I want to do is I want to take care of some low-hanging fruit related to the aesthetics of the website. Number one, I want to turn this color white because it's kind of a gray color right now, and I want it to be white. And the other thing is I want to add the shop page, that photo portfolio page, to the menu item right here, so that it's not only on the home page, but it's also in the navigation, so anyone can easily find it no matter where they are on the website. So number one, let's add the shop page to the menu item right here by going up to the top over here, hovering over the website name, and going directly to the menus page. Here on the menus page, I'm going to click on this link here for shop, and then I'm going to click on add to menu to add this to the menu, and I'm going to drag the shop page up a little bit so it falls right after the about page. Then I'm going to click on save menu to save my menu. Once the shop page has been added to the menu, the other thing I want to do is change the background color of the website to white. To do that, I'm going to come to the left-hand side, hover over Appearance, and click on Customize. Here we have the visual view of what the website looks like now, and we can see there's a gray section right here, and I want that to be white so that everything is just really clean and really white. Also note that right now we're looking at the tablet view. This is not the laptop view, and that's why everything is kind of stacked one on top of the other, because this is the responsive view that you would see if you're viewing the website on a tablet or an iPad or something like that. So here on the left-hand side where it says site title and tagline, I'm going to click on that. Here you want to add your site title as well as your tagline. When you install WordPress, the default tagline is just another WordPress website, which is never a good website tagline. So either just delete that altogether or add your custom tagline. Once you've added the site title and the tagline, you can click on Save and Publish to save the change right there. Once it's been saved, the next section here is colors, and that's what we need to change this from gray to white, so I'm going to click on that. Then I'm going to click on Select Colors, and you can either add the hex code right here, or you can simply choose any of these colors right here. Note that when you choose the colors, it will show in real time what it's going to look like to give you a preview. So I want white, so I'm just going to choose white like that, and then we can scroll down. If you want to change your header image, you can do so right here. I'm going to keep my logo and header image. You can add a background image if you like. I'm not going to add a background image. And you can also set the navigation, which we've already set, so I'm not going to touch that. And then finally, if you want to set the static front page, you can do that as well. I'm going to keep everything as it is. I'm not going to make any other changes. I'm going to leave it as your latest post, which will look like this. Then I'm going to click on Save and Publish to publish and save my changes with the white background. So now I'm going to click on Close, and when we visit the site by going to the website name and clicking on Visit Site, now we can see I have my white background and I have the shop page right here, which is really great. Now we're going to be changing the styles of the theme throughout the theme, but we'll do that last. The next step is I want to add the call to action box right here, as well as the widget areas in the footer. So to add the MailChimp email box right here, or a call to action form and button here. I'll show you both ways. We're going to go back to the widget area by clicking on dashboard. Then I'm going to go to appearance, hover over appearance, and click on widgets. Here on the widget page, we can add a call to action to the home page by clicking on this section here to open this section up. And we can see that previously in the video, we added a placeholder for text. So I'm just going to open that up right there. And now we can see we can add any kind of content we want here in the call to action section. So I'm going to show you two different options that you can add to the call to action section. Of course, you can add any of these other widgets if you'd like, but this is really designed to feature text and a button. So when we go to the Executive Pro demo site right here, we can see that on the demo site, they've included a call to action banner, a short sentence, and then this button, Contact Us Today, and this button can go directly to the contact page. So when we go to the Executive Pro theme setup directions on the StudioPress site, when I scroll down right here, no worries, I will drop the link to this page so you can easily find it. And when we scroll down here, we can see there's a link here, how to configure the home call to action widget area. So when I click on this, it'll bring me down to the call to action section. And here, this is really great because we are provided with the code to create this banner along with the button. So all we need to do is grab the code right here where it says sample content for the call to action banner. So I'm just going to highlight all of this and then I'm going to copy it. And then going back to our widget section here where it says text, I'm not going to add a title, but I'm going to paste that code that I just copied in the previous step. I'm going to paste it in right here. So of course we don't need these numbers 1, 2, 3, so I'm going to delete all of those. Here we can add a title if we'd want. I'm just going to show you for demo purposes, so I'll just add a title. Then you can also customize everything in between these two div tags. So I'm just going to create some carriage returns so you can see what can be customized. So you can customize this entire sentence, whatever you want it to say, you can go ahead and customize that. Then I'm just going to remove the spaces once again. The other thing that can be customized is the link. So here we see where it says href, and then there's an equal sign and two quotation marks, and in between the two quotation marks is a pound symbol. This is where you can add the URL link for whatever you want, wherever you want this button to link to. So I'm just going to create a few spaces here to show you how you would do this. So you want to create the link or add the URL link in between the two quotation marks. There's one quotation mark here that's the opening quotation mark, and there's another closing quotation mark right here. So you want to delete this pound symbol, and then you just want to add whatever your URL is that you want to link to. So if I want to link to my contact page, I happen to know that the link for that is simply my domain name followed by /, and then contact. So I would just add that right here, make sure that you spell it right, contact, and then note that I have all my quotations set. So you can really just kind of leave it like that, and then we can simply scroll down, click on save, and once this is saved, when we go to the website by going up to the site name and clicking on visit site, now when we scroll down, we'll see that here is the banner title, here's the short sentence, and then here's our button, and when we click on this, it will lead to our contact page, which is really great. So in addition to having a title, some text, and a call to action button here in the call to action widget area, the other option that we can include instead includes an email opt-in form, which is my personal preference. So checking out my demo site over here, we can see that I have a horizontal email opt-in form here with a call to action to sign up to get your 10-minute weekly recipe. So having an email opt-in form is one of the most important things you could have on your business website, because an email marketing list is one of the best ways to stay in touch with visitors who come to your website who are interested in what you have to offer. So it's also always a really good idea to have this email opt-in form above the fold somewhere around here on the website, because studies show that a lot of people actually don't scroll down below the page. So the higher up you can have and more front and center you can feature this email opt-in form, the better. So the great thing about this particular email opt-in form is that I'm using the Magic Action Box widget, which is awesome. I love this plugin. It's such a great plugin, and I've created another video on my YouTube channel that goes over how to set up the Magic Action Box email opt-in form. So I'm going to refer you to check out this video called Capture Leads on Your WordPress Website with One Plugin, and I will drop the link in the video so that you can easily check out this video and set up your Magic Action Box. So this video will guide you step by step from scratch, showing you how to create an email opt-in form that looks just like this. I will be including the colors and everything so that if you're interested in having these colors, I will drop these colors in the video so that you can customize the form so that it looks just like it does right here on my demo website. So once you've completed that video, then you should have your email opt-in form just like this ready to go. So the next thing that we'll need to do after that has been added is the footer section right down here. The great thing about the footer section is that because these are three widgets, you can add whatever customizable content that you'd like. In this video, I'll be adding a search box and some social icons, as well as a short description about the site and a video. So to start adding this, I'm going to go back to my website and go to the dashboard. Then I'm going to hover over appearances and I'm going to click on widgets. Next, on the footer widget section, I'm going to scroll down. We can see we have three different footer widget sections right here. So I'm going to open each one of these up so we can add some customizable content to these sections. You can add any of the widgets here that we see in the available widgets area. Okay, so the ones that I want, number one, I want a search box so that any visitor can easily search throughout my website. So here is the search widget. I'm just going to grab this, drag it up to footer number one, then I'll just release it right here, and I'll add a title, looking for something with a question mark. Okay, once I have my title, I'm just going to click on save to save this title and the settings. Next, I'm going to add a placeholder for the social icon. So I'm just going to close this search box right there. Then I'm going to come down and I'm going to grab this text widget and just drag it up just underneath the search widget on the footer one section right here. We'll come back to this because we need to create the social icons and the links. So this is just a placeholder right now. Next, I'm also going to add some content here related to the site in footer two. So once again, I'll come down, grab the text widget right here, and I'll drag that up to footer number two. And here in the text box for the title, I'm going to just say about Katrina.com because this is my website. So I'll just create a title about the website, and then I'll add some content right here about the website. Note also that here it says read more. So I do want to create a link for this so that anyone can just click on this and it will turn into a link. So I'm just going to add some HTML code here that will create the link. So this is the opening link tag right here. So it'll just have the opening link tag, and this is the link that when you click on read more, it will go to the about page on my website. And you just want to close out the entire link with a closing a bracket. So I'm just going to add the closing bracket right there. Then I'm just going to scroll down and click on save to save this widget right here. Finally, in footer number three, I'm going to add a video. So once again, I'm going to come down to the bottom, going to grab the text widget and drag that up to footer number three. And here I need to go to YouTube and I need to find the video as well as the embed code. So going to YouTube, Here on my YouTube channel, this is a video that I want to add to my website. So to add this particular video to my website, we need to get the embed code. So to get the embed code, I'm just going to come down here, click on share. I'm also going to create a custom size of 300 pixels wide because this is the width of the widget area. Then I'm just going to highlight all of this code right here and copy it. Then I'm going to go back to my widget right here. I'm going to scroll down, and here in my text widget, I'm going to paste the code. Once the code has been pasted, then I'm going to save the code by clicking on save, and then I'm going to go back to my website by clicking on visit site to check it out. So here on my website, when I scroll down to the footer, here we can see the search box, some info about the website, as well as the video. The next thing that I want to add here in the footer are some social network icons along with some links that go to my various social networks. So I'm going to be using some Creative Commons icons from Design Deck. These are some free icons that we can use for both personal as well as commercial use. So I'll be sure to drop the link for these great resources. These are beautiful icons right here. I love these. So I'll be sure to drop the link so that you can check these out if you want to follow along. As it notes over here, you can use these circle icon set any way you'd like, be it commercially or personally, but they do have some restrictions on how the zip file is used, and you can check that out right here. Check out what the restrictions are. So, but for commercial or personal use, we're able to use these. So I'm going to download these by clicking on the download link right here. Next, if you'd like to help Design Deck out by tweeting before you download, you can do so by clicking on tweet. I'm not signed in right now to Twitter, so I'm just going to click on skip to download. Once icons have been downloaded, the easiest way to add them to the website is to create a temporary post. So I'm going to come up to the top, hover over plus new, and click on post. This is a post we're going to be creating just to get the icons all set up, and then we're going to delete the post. So if you don't know any code, or if you don't want to take the time to create it, by allowing WordPress to create the code for us behind the scenes, it can really save us some time. So I'm just going to place the cursor right here, and then I'm going to click on add media, and I'm going to upload all of the images that I need, all the icons, all at once. So I'm going to click on upload files, then select files. Then here we see, here's the folder of all the icons. So I'm going to double click on this. I'm going to choose the JPEG version. So I'm going to double click on JPEG, and the ones that I want are the color version. So I'm going to double click on the color folder right there, and then I'm going to select the icons that I want. So I want the Facebook icon. I would like the Twitter icon, the YouTube icon, as well as the Google Plus icon. So I'm going to upload these four icons all at once by clicking on choose. As we've done in the previous images, it's always a good idea to add a title and an alternative text. So you want to do that for each of these different icons. I'm not going to do that right now. I'll come back to that later just to save some time, but it's a good idea to add those two things to each of these images. Next, I'm going to click on insert into post to insert all of these into the post. Now note that these are all centered right now, and I really don't want them to be centered on my page. So I'm just going to highlight all of them right here, and I'm going to click on the left alignment right here. Next, I'm going to choose one by one, and actually it's a little bit easier when you go on the text version of this, and I'm going to create some space in between each of these different icons. So each of these icons starts with IMG, a bracket in IMG, so I'm just going to create a little bit of space in between each of these so I can grab each one of them. And then going back to the visual tab right here, it looks like I'm going to try and grab that one, for example. So I'm going to grab one at a time, and then I'm going to create a link. So this icon right here, as we hover on top of it, it says insert, edit a link. So I'm going to click on that. Then I'm just going to add the link going to my different social networks. So this is, once again, if you don't know the code, or if you just want to speed up the time to create the code, this is a great way to use WordPress to let WordPress create the code for us. So I'm just going to add it like that, and then I'll click on open link, a new tab, and click on add link. We can do the same thing for each of these. I'm just going to add a different URL for each of the different URL social network icons. Okay, once we have the code as we'd like it to be, I'm just going to highlight all of it in one fell swoop, and then I'm going to copy it. Then I'm going to go back to my widget area by hovering over appearance and clicking on widgets. Then I'm going to scroll down, and here in footer one, I'm going to click on this, and here's our text placeholder. So I'm going to open that up. Then I'm just going to paste in the code that I copied in the previous step. Next, I'm going to scroll down and click on save to save this code. Next, I'm going to check it out by going back to the site by hovering over the website name and clicking on Visit Site. And now when I scroll down to the footer area here, we can see here are each of our icons. Now note that there's this white background right here, but eventually we are going to be changing this black background to be white. So we're not going to see this square shape right here. We'll see each of these will just be lined up one next to the other. Now these are kind of large, which is why the fourth icon here is kind of carrying on to the next row. So I may want to just reduce the size of these, all of them, so that they're all lining up one by one across in one row. In the meantime, we still have the primary sidebar to set up as well. So going to the blog page, I'm going to click on blog here at the top, and we can see that we have this primary sidebar widget area that needs to be configured. So to do that, I'm going to go back to the widget area by clicking on widgets. Next, we can see here is the primary sidebar, so I'm going to open that up right here. Here in the primary sidebar, the first widget that I want to add is a search box. So I'm going to scroll down to the bottom, find the search widget, and then I'm going to drag it up into the primary sidebar. Then underneath the search box, the next widget that I want to add is the Genesys eNews Extended widget. So I'm just going to drag this up and add it underneath the search box right here. Now this particular box is very similar to the Magic Action box, only it has a different kind of layout to it. We'll see in just a moment. It looks a lot different than the Magic Action box. You can use either one, but I'm going to show you how to set this up in the event that you want to use this instead or in addition to. So the first thing is we need to give this a title. So I'm just going to add a title in right here. Next, I'm going to add some text to show before the form. Then when we scroll down, we can see that we can connect this with Google or our FeedBurner ID. Instead, I'm going to connect this with my MailChimp account. So if you want to use MailChimp, then all you need to do is go to MailChimp. You can create a free account up to 2,000 email subscribers. So they also have some premium pricing if you have more than 2,000 subscribers. But if you're just getting started, the free account usually works for pretty much everyone. And once you log into your free MailChimp account, you'll arrive on the dashboard. So the first thing that you're going to want to do is create a list. So I'm just going to click on this just to show you how this looks. So you're going to want to click on Create List and then click on this button here that says Create List. And then when you click on each of these buttons right here, then it will give you an example of what the field should look like. So you can kind of just go one by one and fill out your email list right here. And then once you have your email list set up, then when you click on the left-hand link over here, you'll see your list. So I just created some demo lists right here just for this particular video. So I'm going to click on this new list that I just created. And the next step is once you click on your list, then you want to click on Sign Up Forms. And then you want to click on Embedded Forms right here. And then the next step is we want to choose a naked form. And we want to pretty much strip this down to pretty much nothing. So I'm going to take the title out, remove the title. I'm going to click on Only Required Fields. And I'm going to remove all of these checkboxes as well, so that at the end we really have a really, really, really basic form right here with just an email address and a subscribe button. Then the actual code that we need, when I click in this, I have to highlight the entire code. So I'm just going to highlight everything and copy it. Then I'm going to open up another window here in my laptop. So if you have an email or a word processor system or any kind of like notepad kind of view here, you just want to paste in the code that we just copied in the previous step. And the code that we actually need, we don't need all this code. The only code we really need is in between these two quotations. After it says form action, there's a quotation mark and it begins with HTTP. So we want to grab the part that says HTTP, and we want to grab everything up until the next quotation mark right here. So I'm just going to grab this URL right here in between the quotation marks. I'm going to copy it, and that is the code that we want to add to our eNews extended widget. So here where it says form action, this is where we're going to add the code that we just copied in the previous step. Next, we want to add an email field and a first name field. So I'm just going to add email right there. And for first name, I'm just going to pop in this. It says F name, F for first, so F name. And this is email. Then scrolling up the page, the one thing that we're missing, it says mail poet list. Mail poet is not currently activated, so Genesis eNews Extended works with Mail Poet, a free newsletter plugin. So I'm just going to save my settings right here so that they are all saved. And then I'm going to go back to this link here, and I'm going to make sure that Mail Poet is set up. So I'm going to click on Mail Poet right here. And here we see the Mail Poet newsletter plugin. So I'm going to just highlight this right here and go back to my website by going to plugins and installed plugins. And I'm going to check to see if I've already installed that. So I'm just going to scroll down. It looks like I haven't added it yet. So I'm going to go ahead and click on Add New. Then I'm going to paste in this particular widget, plugin. It's Mail Poet Newsletters. That's what it's called, Mail Poet Newsletters. Then I'm going to click on Search Plugins. And here we see it right at the top, Mail Poet Newsletters. So I'm going to install this now. Yes, okay. And once the plugin has been installed, I'm going to activate it by clicking on Activate Plugin. Once the plugin has been activated, now we can see it at the bottom in our list here, this WY Wisija newsletters link right here, this plugin, so that's good. Now when I go back to appearance and widgets, I'm going to click on widgets one more time and go to my primary sidebar and the Genesis eNews Extended plugin widget right here. And now it looks like, okay, the Mail Poet list is, I now have some more options right here. So I'm going to click on the fields to show the first name right there so that the first name does display. Then I'm going to scroll down and click on Save to save my settings. So now when I go to my widgets, I'm going to go up to the top, click on Visit Sites. And now when I click on the blog page right here by clicking on blog, now we can see here I have my email opt-in form using the Genesis eNews widget, what plugin. So that is really, really great. Now, once again, we'll change the styles in just a few moments, but it's awesome that we have our email opt-in form really easy to see front and center on the sidebar. So let's continue adding a few more items to our primary widget area. So I'm going to go back to the widget by clicking on, hovering over the website name and going directly to the widgets page. Next here in the primary sidebar, the other thing that I'm going to add is I'm also going to add the social network icons that I also added to the footer. So I'm going to go down to the footer, open this up just a moment, and then I'm going to copy all of this code. So I'm just going to highlight all of it and copy it. And then I'm going to grab a text widget down below and I'm going to drag it underneath the eNews widget in the primary sidebar. So I'm just dragging this text widget here underneath the eNews extended widget. And then I'm going to paste in all those social icons with the links underneath the eNews opt-in form. Then I'm going to click on Save to save this widget. Next, on the left-hand side here, we can see there's a number of different items we can add, a Facebook like box with Jetpack, or the one that I want to add though is I want to add my Twitter timeline right here, the Twitter timeline. So with this one, I can display an official Twitter embedded timeline widget, which is really cool. So I'm just going to drag this underneath the social icons on my primary widget area. Let's see where that is, right here at the top. And I'm just going to add that right here, follow me on Twitter. I'll just say follow on Twitter. Next, the width, I'm going to make the width 300 pixels because that is the width of the sidebar area. 400 looks good. The number of tweets, I'm going to show one tweet. Then I'm just going to save this just so I have saved the settings right here. And the other thing is we need to find the widget ID for my Twitter account. So to create a widget, I'm going to click on this link here that says create a widget at twitter.com. Then you need to sign in to your Twitter account. So I'm just going to sign in. Then once you sign into Twitter, you can just add your username. You can choose whether you want to exclude replies or auto expand photos. Then I'm just going to click on this link here that says create widgets. Once again, here is the code that's created. So we just need part of it. So I'm just going to highlight all of it though and copy it. Then in my notepad over here, I'm just going to add in or paste in the code that I just copied in the previous step. So the ID number, we'll see it right here when you paste the code code in, it'll say ID number equals, and then there's two quotations, and then there's a number in between these two quotations. So I'm just going to highlight that number and copy it. Then you want to go back to your WordPress website, and then here where it says widget ID, you want to paste in this ID number. Then you can choose whether you want to have different layout options like no header, no footer, no borders, no scroll bar, or a transparent background. I'm going to choose pretty much all these. I do want a header though, but I don't want a footer, borders, or a scroll bar. Okay, then you can choose the link color if you'd like, whether you want the light timeline theme or the dark. I'm going to keep it light because it's a white website. Then I'm going to click on save to save my changes. Finally, the last thing that I'm going to add to the primary sidebar are some recent posts. So right underneath the Twitter timeline, I'm going to scroll down here and find the recent post widget right here, and I'm just going to drag that underneath the Twitter timeline of the primary sidebar. So I'm just going to post it in right there. By default, we can show 5 of the posts. I'm only going to choose 3 though, so I'll just put 3 right there, and then I'll click on save. Once that's saved, I'm going to check out the primary sidebar by going up to the site, clicking on visit site. Then I'm going to go to the blog by clicking on blog. And here we can see the primary sidebar with the search box, the email opt-in form. We have our social icons right here, our Twitter timeline. If anyone wants to follow me, they can just click on this button, which is really great, really easy. And then finally, we've got the recent posts. So that looks really good. Here is the rest of the blog archive page, and we've got our footer down here as well. So we have a few things that we need to do still. This looks pretty much good overall. It's pretty much done. The only thing that we really need to do now is completely change all the colors and the styles and the fonts of the website. So let's do that next. So before we customize the website, I just realized that we still need to create a landing page and add the landing page to the menu area right here. So what we're going for is we're going to be adding a landing page called Free Resources to our website. And when I click on this particular link, we come to this landing page where we can see there's no logo or menu, there's no sidebar, and there's no footer. The purpose of a landing page is really to call to attention the offer or service or product that you want your reader to focus on and that you want them to take immediate action on. So that's why all the other stuff that may be distracting or detracting from the message is not on the page. So also one thing to note about landing pages, you also should include the reasons why you want someone to take the action on the landing page. So to create this page in our theme, the good news is that our theme comes with this template, a landing page template. So to create a landing page in the Executive Pro theme, we're going to come up to the top, hover over plus new, and click on page. Then the first thing we want to do is we want to give our new page a title. I'm going to call this Free Resources because I want anyone who visits my landing page to sign up to receive free resources. Then here in the white box, I'm going to add my content. So this is just some demo content, but it will include the reasons why someone should sign up to get the free resources. So here we have reason number 1, reason number 2. Then on the right-hand side here where it says page attributes, there's a template option. I'm going to click on that. And this is where we want to choose the landing template. Next, we can just scroll down. I'm going to turn off all comments because I don't want any comments on this page. And then the other thing that I'm going to do here is I do want to display an email opt-in form. So previously in this video, I went over how to set up an email opt-in form using the magic action box, and I referred you to the email opt-in video that I have on my YouTube channel specifically related to the magic action box. So if you followed along so far, hopefully you have this plugin activated and set up. I do, so I'm just going to come here and I'm going to choose the one that I want, which I'm going to choose this one, the homepage one, and then I'm going to scroll up and I'm going to click on publish to publish my new page. Once the page has been published, we can check it out by clicking on view page. And here we can see we have our landing page. So there's no logo, no menu, no sidebar, and no footer, and no comments. Once again, the focus is simply on the content, the message of the page. And then I have my call to action right here that is inviting everyone to sign up for my free resources. So the next step is let's add this page to our menu. To add this to our menu, I'm going to go back to the dashboard by clicking on dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to appearance, hover over appearance, and click on menus. Then we can see here under pages, here is my landing page right here that says free resources. So I'm going to click on this, add it to my menu, and there it shows up at the bottom. So I'm going to leave it in that order. Next, I'm going to save my menu by clicking on save menu. Okay, so now we've created our landing page and we've added it to our menu. When I go up to the top to visit the site, now we can see the new landing page added right here in the menu. Okay, so now let's go about customizing our WordPress website. So whenever we're making customizations and changes to our WordPress website, it's always important to first create a child theme so that in the event the developer updates the parent theme, the changes that you've made will not be overwritten. In a previous video on my YouTube channel, I went over how to create a child theme and how to set up an FTP account. So the question is though, what do you do when you already have a child theme? How do you safely customize a child theme that you already have? Because in our instance here, we have the parent theme, which is the Genesis framework, and we already have the child theme, which is the Executive Pro child theme. So in order to safely update and change and customize the child theme, in our case now, we need to create a separate CSS file called custom.css. So in order to do this, we actually do need an FTP account. So I'm going to refer you to this video to learn how to create an FTP account if you don't have one and where to get the software. I will drop the timestamp in this video so you'll be able to go directly to the section of this video that you need to watch related to FTP accounts. Once you have your FTP account, then we can come back to our website here, and we're going to need to create a custom.css file and upload it via FTP. So to create the custom.css file, I'm going to go to my desktop over here, and I'm going to copy the style.css file that is the style for this child theme. So to show you what I mean, I'm going to open up this folder right here. This is the Executive Pro Theme Child Theme folder files. So I'm going to double click on this and open it. Then I'm going to find the style that I need. This is the actual style.css. This is the style, the current style of our child theme. So all the black here and the small white font, all of these styles are included right now in the style.css file. So I'm just going to copy this and I'm going to add it to my desktop so I can easily find it. That way I have two separate versions. The original style.css will stay in my Executive Pro theme folder files right there. But once the actual style.css is copied on my desktop, from here, I can rename it. So I'm going to rename this duplicate from style.css. This is a duplicate. So I'm going to rename this as custom.css. So this is my custom.css file. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up a text editor. I'm on a Mac, so I'm going to use Text Edit. If you're on a PC, you can open up your file in Notepad. So here I am in Text Edit. I'm just going to open that up. Then in Text Edit, I'm going to go to File and then Open, and I'm going to open up my new custom.css file. From here, I'm going to delete pretty much everything in this file with the exception of the section here with all the details that explain what this particular file is. So I'm going to leave everything between the forward slash and the asterisk. I'm going to keep all of this, and I'm going to keep everything up until asterisk forward slash. So this part right here, starting with forward slash asterisk table of contents, all of that I'm going to delete. So we just see here, I'm just highlighting everything here. I'm going to delete all of this from this file so that all we have at the top is the details of the custom.css file. Okay, so here is what my custom.css file looks like now. And here where it says theme name, I'm just going to give this a new name because this is not the Executive Pro theme, actually. Now it's the child theme of the child theme in a way. So I'll just call this Executive Pro theme customized. You can call it anything you want, but I'm just going to call it this so that I know that these are my customized styles for the Executive Pro theme. Once you have it looking like this, then you can just save your file one more time. So we're just going to save it. And once the file is saved, now we need to upload it via FTP to our website files. So I'm just going to close it there. Then I'm going to open up my FTP software right here. Once again, refer to the video that I mentioned on my YouTube if you need help creating an FTP account and setting up your FTP software. Once you've logged in to your FTP account, then we can upload the custom.css file to our FTP. So here's all my theme files. I'm going to go to WP Content. So I'm going to double click on this to open that. Then I'm going to go to Themes. So I'm going to double click on Themes. Next, I'm going to go to my child theme here, which is Executive-Pro. And here we can see the style.css file, which is the existing style sheet for my theme. So now what we need to do is simply drag the custom CSS file into my FTP account right here. So I'm just going to drop custom.css in here. Let's see if it sticks. There we go. Next, I'm going to click continue to continue the transfer. Once the transfer has been completed, then we'll see the custom.css file in our FTP account folder right here. Okay, next I'm going to reduce the FTP window by clicking on this yellow middle button. Then I'm going to go back to my website, and here on my website, I'm going to go to dashboard. Here on the WordPress dashboard, then I'm going to scroll down, hover over appearance, and click on editor. And here we can see on the right-hand side, we have our style.css file. This is where all the styles of our current child theme are located. We're not going to touch any of these styles right here. Instead, we're going to be adding our custom styles in the custom.css file. Now, we've added the custom.css file to our WordPress website themes, but we haven't yet told the theme to look for this file. So there's one last step that we need to take. So to complete the process of setting up the custom.css file, we need to next go to Genesis. I'm going to hover over Genesis here and click on Theme Settings. Next, I'm going to scroll down, and all the way at the bottom, there's a section here that says Header and Footer Scripts. And we need to add a script here, some code, into the WP underscore head, and there's two parentheses here. We need to add a code into this box right here in the header script. So I'm going to add the code that we need right here, and I'm going to make sure that I do drop this code in the video. You're going to want to make a note of this because you will need this to make this all work. So I'll make sure that I drop the code in the video. So basically there's a bracket and it says link space rel, R-E-L, and then equals a parentheses style sheet, another parentheses, or I should say a hyphen, it's just like one little line, type equals, then there's a little line again, text CSS, another little line, href equals, and then this section here where it says http://, this is where you want to put your own domain name. So whatever your domain name is, yourdomain.com, you want to add that here, and then you want to add the exact file directory link right here that you have where you've added the custom.css file. So if you've been following along closely in the video, remember we added it to the WP content folder, then we added it to the themes folder, and then we added it to the Executive Pro folder, and we called it custom.css. So if you followed everything exactly how I showed in the video without making any modifications, then the only thing you'll need to change right here is make it yourdomain.com, whatever your domain is, .com, .org, .net, whatever it is. So all of this, once again, really important to make this all work. You want to add that to your header script. Then we're going to come up to the top and click on Save Settings to save the settings. That script will tell WordPress to look for the custom CSS file and all the styles in it and load those styles before the actual child themed styles. Now that we have our custom CSS file ready to go, now we can safely customize our Genesis WordPress website. So starting with the fonts here in the navigation area, I'd like these to be much larger, and I'd like to add some Google fonts to this particular style so that the end result will look something like this. We can see that the menu navigation items are much larger, they're all capitalized, the color is different, and I'm using Google fonts. So starting with Google fonts, there's a really great post on this on studiopress.com, so I'll be sure to drop the link to this post in the video. But basically, you want to go to google.com/fonts and you want to find one of the fonts that you'd like to use. So in this example, I would like to use the Open Sans condensed font, so I'm going to do a search for that, and here we can see the result of my search. Next, I'm going to click on this, and we can see there's three different kinds. There's light 300, bold 700, and light 300 italic. So I'd like to add the light 300 version, so there's three buttons here. I'm going to click on the middle button, which says quick use. And when I click on quick use, we can see here we first choose the styles that you want. So I'm choosing the light 300 version. Then I'm going to scroll down. I'm going to leave that all set. I'm not going to touch that. But then this is the important part right here. There's three different ways to add this code to your website: a standard way, an import way, and a JavaScript way. So following the post here on studiopress.com, I'm just going to click on the middle button here that says ampersand import. And then I'm going to copy this entire code right here that says at import, and there's a URL. So I'm going to copy all of this code right here. Then I'm going to go back to my website. I'm going to go to dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to appearance and editor. And here we can see on the right hand side, we have our style.css file and our custom.css file. So of course, we want to use the custom.css file. So I'm going to click on that. And then right here in this box here, I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. So this is where we're going to add the import URL code for Google Fonts. Then I'm going to scroll down and click on update file. Once we've added the import with the Google Fonts code to our style sheet, the next step is we need to define where we want this font to be used. So the next step is I'm going to go back to my site. I'm going to click on visit site. Now I'm using a Google Chrome browser, and there's a tool that I'm going to use, a developer tool called Inspect Elements, to find the code related to this style right here. So in the Google Chrome browser, in the top right hand corner, there's three lines. I'm going to click on those. Then, actually, I'm going to move this over just a bit so you can see it. I'm going to click on these three lines, then I'm going to hover over Tools, and then I'm going to click on Developer Tools. Once I click on Developer Tools, it will pull up all the code that is generating my website. The HTML will be on the left-hand side, and the CSS styles will be on the right-hand side. So my next step is I need to drill down into the code here, and I need to find the code related to the menu items. So we can see when I hover over the code right here, different parts of the website will highlight, and that designates the code related to the website. So we can see here I'm clicking on header, and the header is highlighted. So I'm just going to drill down until I find the code related to the menu items. Here we can see on the left-hand side, when I drill down within the HTML, I arrive at this code right here, menu-item. When I hover over this, or I should say just stick the cursor on this, we can see in the top right-hand side in this header section that this section highlights. So this is the code that we need to change. Note that this here on the left-hand side is the HTML code, and this code on the right-hand side is the CSS styles. The good news is that we can change the styles here within Inspect Elements safely without really changing our theme. So this is a great place to experiment, just kind of like a little sandbox here where we can change the styles and see what it looks like. So for example, when I see the Genesis-nav-menu section right here, I can change the font size from the current font size, which is 14 pixels or 1.4 rem. I'm going to uncheck that to turn that off, and then we see that the font size of 14 pixels is now activated, and I can change that by just overriding the 14 here, and I'm going to make it a 30. So note that as soon as I do that, now this font size is a lot larger. So this is the font style that we need to change. So to change it, I'm just going to highlight this entire section right here, copy it, highlight it, and copy it. And then I'm going to go back to my dashboard by clicking on dashboard on my website. Next, I'm going to go to appearance and editor. Then I'm going to go to the custom CSS style by clicking on custom.css. And here I'm going to paste the code that we copied in the previous step. So the first thing is I want to add my Google Fonts to the nav menu. So I'm just going to add a carriage return there, and then I'm going to add my new font family, and I'm going to make sure that I include Open Sans Condensed, and note that there are spaces in between Open Sans and Condensed, and I have this little hyphen here. I'll be sure to include this code in the video, so no worries if you can't see it. And then I finished with a semicolon right there. Next, I'm also going to change the color from the default color of 666 to this other color, and I'm also going to close it off with a semicolon. I want the font size to be 30 pixels, so I'll leave it as 30 pixels. I'm going to remove this other font size, which kind of carried over from before, but I don't need that. And I do want the height, the line height, I'd like that to be 34 pixels. As we can see here on my completed website, the styles of the navigation menu items are all capitalized, so I also want to capitalize them in my code. So to do that, I'm going to add a text transform style right there. And finally, note that the completed website here features a white background instead of the gray background. So by default, there's a gray background on the menu navigation items right here. I want it to be white. So here in my code, I'm going to add a style to make this white. So background refers to the background color of the navigation menu items, and this code, 6Fs, FFF, FFF with a pound and a semicolon, that's a white color code. So once you have this all ready to go, go ahead and click on Update File to update your file. Now we check out the site by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site. Now we see the menu items feature our Google font, the Open Sans condensed font style, and a larger size, and also everything is capitalized with a white background, which is exactly how I want it. Now note that when we look at this particular one, there's this blue background. This is the currently active tab, so we also need to change this color so that it's better blending with this kind of emerald turquoise color right here. So next we need to find out what the code is that generates this blue background. So to find the code that generates this blue background, once again, we need to use Google Chrome's Inspect Element. So coming up to the top right-hand corner here, I'm going to click on these three lines, then hover over Tools, and then click on Developer Tools. As we did in the previous example, I need to drill down one by one until I find the code that is generating this blue background. So as I drill down in the HTML section over here, I arrive at this link, and we can see when I hover over this, then this section right here highlights. We also see that there's the blue color right over here in the CSS window. So if I change this color, I'm going to change this to white because I actually want it to be white. White color is 6Fs, so I'm going to add 6Fs here. Now we see that the entire color changes. Note that the color of the font is also white though, so when we make the background color white and the font color white, then we don't see anything at all. So I'm also going to change the font color right here by changing this white color to an emerald kind of green color. Okay, so that is the way I'd like it to look. I want the green color when this is the current tab, and I want a white background. So I'm just going to copy all this code that I just changed in this sandbox window here in Inspect Elements. I'm going to highlight it all and copy it. Then I'm going to go to my custom CSS file by going to Dashboard, then scrolling down to Appearance and Editor. And here in custom CSS, I'm going to click on that link and go to the custom CSS file, and then I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Next, I'm going to update my file by clicking on Update File. And once the file has been edited successfully, I'm going to go check it out by clicking on Visit Site. Great, so now we can see that this current tab has an aqua turquoise color with a white background. Next, I want to change the color of this excerpt box here. So again, going to Inspect Elements, I'm going to go up to the top, click on the three lines, hover over Tools, and click on Developer Tools. Then once again, I'm going to drill down until I find the block here that is responsible for this background color. Once again, we can see when I drill down through the HTML code right here and I land on this div class with the slide excerpt slide, that's what it says right here, we can see that it highlights on the left-hand side. So we've successfully selected the correct content area for this excerpt block. So the code that we need to change corresponds to this div class right here. We can see it's on the right-hand side, and the default background color is 222. So we can see here the element is .content.genesis_responsive_slider, slide excerpt, and here with the background color, when I change this color of 2 to something else, so I'm going to change it to this kind of grayish blue color, we can see that it changes here on the left-hand side. So this is the background color that I'm going to use for this particular section of the site. So as we did before, I need to copy all of this, highlight it and copy it, and then going back to my custom style sheet, I'm going to click on Dashboard, then go down to Appearance and Editor. And here when I go to custom.css, I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Also make sure that you close the style with a closing tilde bracket. So I'm just going to add that right here. And then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Once the file has been edited successfully, we can check it out by clicking on Visit Site. And here we see that this content box here with the excerpt now has this grayish blue background, which is great. Okay, so the next thing I want to change here on the homepage are the title styles right here in the excerpt box. So once again, we're going to use Inspect Elements. I'm going to click on these three lines, hover over Tools, click on Developer Tools, and I'm going to search for the code that is generating the styles for this title. Here we see when I drill down through the HTML here, I arrive at the Header 2 tag, and we can see when I highlight or click on this or hover over this H2, it highlights over here on the left-hand side. Once again, on the right-hand side here in this area, in this column, we have the CSS styles, and these are the styles that need to be changed. Starting with the font weight right over here, we see the code for the style is .content.genesis_responsive_slider_h2, and there's also an A here which responds to a link. So we need to change all of that. So here the color is okay, I'll keep it as white. The font size, I think I may want to change that in just a moment. I'm going to change that actually to 28, so I'm going to click on font size here. Instead of 20 pixels, I'm going to make it 28 pixels. A little bit larger. I'm also going to make the font weight normal, or I should say 400. I'll just change that to 400 to make it not so bold. I want to keep it uppercase, and I also want to change the font family, which we can see down below right here. We see H1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. All of these header styles are using the font family of Open Sans, Helvetica New, Helvetica, Arial, and Sans Serif. I would like to use the Google font that I added to my website, which is the Open Sans Condensed Google font. So for this particular area right here, I'm just going to click in this area and I'm going to change that to Open Sans Condensed. Okay, then right up top over here, these are the styles that I'm going to copy. So I'm just going to copy all of these right there, highlight them and copy them. I'm also going to just keep in mind right here that I also have to change the H1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. The H, all these H headers need to have the new font family of Open Sans Condensed. So I'm not going to highlight that. I'm just going to kind of remember that in my head. That's pretty easy for me to remember right now. But I do need to copy this section right here, which I just copied. Then I'm going to add it to my custom CSS file by clicking on Dashboard. Then once again, scrolling down to Appearance and clicking on Editor. Then I'm going to click on custom.css, and here in my custom CSS file, at the very bottom, I'm going to paste in the code that I just copied in the previous step. There we go. So here we go right here. I'm going to eliminate this font size 2rem because I just added it right here. We have font size 28 pixels. We have the color looks good. The font weight is now 400. I didn't really change the text transform. It was by default, it is uppercase. It's still uppercase. So I'm going to delete that. In this file here, in the custom CSS file, we only need to add the code that has actually been changed. If you haven't changed any code, then there's really no need to add a custom style here because it's the same code. So I'm going to take that text transform out. Keep in mind, I'm also going to be adding this font family. So I'm just going to copy this right here, this code. I had remembered this in the previous step. I was like, remember this. Now I remember it. I'm going to copy that right there. And I'm going to change all of the header styles all in one swoop. So I'm just going to make them H1, H2, H3, H4, H5, H6. Then I'm going to add this opening tilde bracket right here. I'm going to paste in the code I just copied in the previous step with the new font family. This is the Google font that we added previously in the video. And I'm going to close out the entire new customized style with a closing tilde bracket. Okay, so all of this, I'm just going to update the file by clicking on Update File. And once the file has been updated successfully, we can go check it out by clicking on Visit Site. Okay, great. So now we have the new font styles for our title. The next step is I want to change the content that shows up underneath the title, and I also want to add a button. So to change the content from the beginning of the blog post to an excerpt, I'm going to go back up to the dashboard, click on Dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to Genesis, hover over Genesis, and click on Slider Settings. Here on Genesis Slider Settings, I'm going to scroll down to the bottom, and here where it says Content Settings, select one of the following, Display Post Content or Excerpts. I'm going to choose Display Post Excerpts. Then once that is set, I'm going to click on Save to save my settings. Now I'm going to go back to the homepage by clicking on Visit Site. And now we can see that my excerpt is showing instead of the actual content from my post. Now I'm going to click on this right here because I want to go to this post and I want to edit it. So here is the actual post. I'm going to click on Edit at the top. Then I'm going to scroll down to my excerpt section, which we see is right here. If you're not seeing excerpts show up below at the bottom of the page, then what you need to do is click on Screen Options and make sure that the excerpts box is checked. Once that's checked, then you will see excerpts at the bottom of the page. So here where it says excerpts, I'm going to add a button. So I'm going to be sure to drop this code in the video, but this is a button code with a break. This BR right here, this is HTML for creating a line break. Then we have the beginning of the link section, the A class, class equals button, a line left, Ahref, right where it says pound, this is where we actually need to add the post, the actual permalink for our post. So going up to the top here, I'm just going to grab it. This is the permalink that I'm using right here, this long thing. So I'm just going to copy all of that. That is the URL for this specific post. And I'm going to paste it right in between these two quotation marks, and I'm going to delete the pound sign. So no worries if you can't see it, I will drop this in the video. Once you have the button code added, then I'm going to come up to the top and click on Update to update my post. Now when I go back to visit the site by going up to the top and clicking on Visit Site, now we see we have our title, we have our excerpt, and we have our button. So the next step is I want to increase the size of this text. This is way too small, so I'm going to increase that. Once again, by using the Inspect Elements tool, clicking on these three lines, Tools, Developer Tools, we're getting the hang of this. And then I'm going to drill down until I can find the paragraph code for this particular excerpt line. Okay, so once I drill down through all this code, here it is right here. When I click on this P right here, we can see on the right-hand side, here's the color. And if I scroll down, I should be able to find the size of this particular font. So here we see this is body. Okay, this is actually being captured in the at-large body code, body styles, which here we see is 16 pixels. So I'm going to actually increase this from 16 to 20. 22. Okay, so that's a little bit easier to read. It's a lot larger, so I'm going to use that. So this is the body tag, and the font style is 22. So I'm just going to highlight this right here, and then I'm going to add it to my custom CSS by clicking on Dashboard. Then going down to Appearance, hovering over Appearance, clicking on Editor. Then I'm going to click on Custom CSS, scroll down, and I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Okay, once I've added the font size for the body styles, I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Then I'm going to go back to the home page by clicking on Visit Site. And here we see the new size for the paragraph body section right there. Now note that this color right here is blue for this button. I'd much rather have it be this emerald green aqua turquoise color to match the rest of the site. So I'm going to change that as well by using Inspect Elements to find out the code for the button. Okay, so drilling down the list, drilling down all the HTML code here, here I find the class for the button, and on the right hand side we can see it's this blue color right here. So I want to change this button color from a blue to the kind of aqua turquoise color. So I'm just going to put in my new color right there. Then, as we did in the previous steps, I'm going to copy all of this code right here, just highlight it and copy it. Then I'm going to go back to my custom CSS file by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down, hover over Appearance, and click on Editor. Then I'm going to click on Custom CSS to go to the custom CSS file, and I'm going to paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure that I close it out with this closing tilde bracket. Once you have this in here, go ahead and click on Update File to update your file. Okay, so once the file has been edited, we can go back to the site by clicking on Visit Site. We're getting the hang of this now. I'm sure we're getting really good at this with the Inspect Elements tool. And okay, everything looks good, and the color now is this emerald kind of aqua color, which is great. Next, we need to change the color of the background section here of the Call to Action widget. Another way to view Inspect Elements on a Mac is to hold down the Control key and then click once on the mouse keypad. You can do the same thing on a PC by right-clicking and then clicking on Inspect Elements. So I'm going to click on Inspect Elements right here, and this will pull up the Inspect Elements panel and go directly to the code we need. So this is kind of a shortcut. I'll be using this method going forward in the video. So here we have the code. This is the block for the Call to Action widget area. We can see on the right hand side here are the styles that are currently being used. So the first thing I want to do is I want to change the background color from this black color to a lighter gray color. So I'll just add in my code right here. Next, I want to change the padding from 60 pixels to 30 pixels, so I'm just going to click in here and add 30 to move things up a bit. And finally, I want to change this alignment of the text in the box, and I want to center it so it's in the middle of the page. So to do that, I'm going to add a new style here called Text Align. And I'm going to give it a text align style of center. So I've changed three different styles here, the background color, the padding, and the text align. I'm going to copy all of this code, highlight it, and copy it. Then I'm going to go back to my custom CSS file by clicking on Dashboard, going down to Appearance and Editor. Then I'm going to click on Custom CSS File, scroll down to the bottom, and paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Note that I'm going to remove the styles that I have not changed because I haven't changed them. Again, here we only want to include the styles we have changed. So I'm going to remove this. And here we have the styles that I've actually customized, the background color, the padding, and the text alignment. Once you have the code in here, go ahead and click on Update File to update your file. Now, going back to the home page by clicking on Visit Site, we can see that our Call to Action widget box here now has this really light color and everything is centered, which is really great. Next, we need to change the font style once again of this title here in the Call to Action widget. So I'm going to go to Inspect Elements by holding down the Control key on a Mac, then clicking on Inspect Elements. And here we can see the H4 class styles that we need to change. So on the right hand side, we can see that currently the font size is really small. So first, I want to make this larger. It's currently 24 pixels. So I'm going to increase that to 34 pixels to make it a little bit larger. Then I'm just going to copy this style right here, highlight it and copy it. And then I'm going to go back to my custom style sheet by clicking on Dashboard, then going down to Appearance and Editor, clicking on custom.css, and then I'm going to scroll to the bottom and paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure that you're closing everything with this tilde bracket. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update the file. Next, going back to the site by clicking on Visit Site. Now we can see the font size is larger, but it's white on a gray background, which is really hard to see, and also the font weight is bold and I want it to be normal. So once again, clicking on Control and then clicking on the mouse keypad Inspect Element, opening up the Inspect Element box, and here on the right side, now we'll address the white color. So I don't want this to be white, it's really hard to see. Instead, I'd rather have it be a kind of gray color. So here on the right hand side where it says white, which is the F color right here, I'm going to make this a kind of gray color. Okay, once again, I'm going to copy all of this, highlight it and copy it. Then I'm going to go back to my custom CSS file by clicking on Dashboard, scrolling down to Appearance, hovering over Appearance and clicking on Editor, then clicking on Custom CSS, scrolling to the bottom and pasting the code that I copied in the previous step. Once the code has been pasted, then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Now going back to Visit Site by clicking on Visit Site, now we can see it looks much easier to read on this light gray background. So finally, the last thing is we need to change the font weight of the title. So once again, opening up Inspect Elements, we can see here's the H4 class once again that we need to edit, and when I scroll down here looking at the styles on the right hand side, we can see that the font weight for this particular element is 700, which is way too much. Actually, H1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, all of these header styles all have a bold font weight. So I want this to be normal, so I'm just going to change it from 700 to normal, and then we can see down below it gets a little bit lighter. So that's what I want. So I'm just going to keep in mind H1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. All of these are already in our style sheet. So I'm just going to close this, go back to our custom style sheet, go to Appearance Editor, then click on Custom CSS. Then I'm going to scroll down to where the header styles are, which are right here. We can see we've already added the Google font to these headers, but this time in addition to the Google font, I'm going to add a font weight of normal, and then you close it off with a semicolon, and you just want to make sure everything is included in between these two brackets. Okay, once we have the font weight as normal, then we can come to the bottom, click on Update File. Now when we visit the site by clicking on Visit Site, now we see that the font weight looks a lot better and everything is centered right in the middle. So that looks really good. So scrolling down, the next thing we need to customize is the footer section right here. Opening up Inspect Elements once again on a Mac by holding down the Control key and clicking on the mouse keyboard and then clicking on Inspect Elements. Here we have our Inspect Elements panel right here. We can see here is the footer widget area. So by default, once again, we have the black background here for the footer area. I want to change that to white. So here in the styles where it says dot footer dash widgets, I'm going to change the 2 to white, which is FFF. And now we can see that the background has a white background, which is great. The other thing is I want to add a top border here in between these three buttons, these three call to action widgets right here. And I want a border line in between the footer section and then these three boxes right here. So to add a top border here where it says dot footer dash widgets, I'm actually going to add this in. I'm going to call it border top. Then I'm going to make it 2 pixels. I'm going to give it a solid color, or I should say a solid style, and I want it to be the color of a light gray. Okay, so now we see that I have my line in between the three boxes here and the footer section. So now I need to copy the styles that I just customized. So I'll just, for the moment, I'll just copy the whole thing and I'll delete the styles I don't need in a moment. So I'm going to copy all of these styles right here. Then I'm going to go back to my dashboard by clicking on Dashboard, scroll into Appearance, clicking on Editor. Next, I'll click on Custom.css, scroll to the bottom, and paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Now note that I didn't change all these styles, so I'm going to remove the styles that were not changed. Okay, so the only styles I've included here are the background color and the border top. Next, I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Going back to Visit Site by clicking on Visit Site, now we see here I have my footer section here. It's all white. That looks good, and I have my border. So the next thing I'm going to do is I need to change the titles. I need to increase them and change the color. So opening up Inspect Elements once again on a Mac, I'm going to hold down the Control key and click on my mouse keyboard. Then I'm going to click on Inspect Element. Here we see the panel opens up and we can see the styles related to the Header 4 tag right here. So looking on the right hand side here, the default color is this gray color. So I'm going to change that so that it's a kind of emerald color and matches the rest of the website. So there we go. And the other thing is we need to increase the size from the small size to a larger size. So scrolling down, I'm going to look for the font size. It looks like it's 16 pixels right here. So I'm going to change that to 30 pixels. Okay, that looks a lot better. So the font styles that I'm going to copy, I'm just going to remember in my mind that this is .widget-title with a font size of 30. And the one that I'm going to change, I should say that I'm going to copy, is this one right here. So I'm going to copy this code right here, highlight it and copy it. It's .footer-widgets.widget-title with my new color. And then I'm just going to keep in mind, the back of my mind, .widget-title is a font size of 30. Okay, then I'm going to go back to my custom CSS file by clicking on Dashboard. Then I'm going to scroll down to Appearance and click on Editor. Then I'm going to click on custom.css, and here I'm going to scroll down to the bottom and paste the code I just copied in the previous step. Okay, so here's the code that I just copied in the previous step with the new color, and then keeping in mind I'm also going to change the font size of that widget title. So the code was widget-title, then I'm going to click on size, and I'm going to close out this entire new code. This is the font style for the widget title. We're increasing it to a font size of 30 pixels. I'm going to add that there and click on Update File to update my file. Now going back to the site by clicking on Visit Site, and now scrolling down, we see that everything is looking a lot better right here. Now we can see these titles and they're the right color. Okay, last here in this section, I need to increase the size of this body style here in the footer section because this is really small, it's hard to read. So I'm going to open up Inspect Elements. Then here we see is the code right here, .footer-widgets. And we can see that the default style is 14 pixels, which is too small. So I'm going to make that 22. And now I can see it a lot better. Also note the color is kind of light. It's a little bit hard to see. So I'm going to make that darker by changing the color right there. Once I've adjusted the colors in the Inspect Elements box, then I'm just going to copy the colors, highlight and copy them. And then, as we did previously, I'm going to add these to my custom style sheet. So going down to Appearance and Editors, then I'm going to click on custom.css, scroll to the bottom, and paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure that I close it all out with this closing bracket. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Now going back to my site by clicking on Visit Sites. Now when I scroll down, my footer looks really good. So we're all good to go. The one thing I want to note is that we do see that this Read More link is in blue, and I would prefer it to be in this color right here instead. So I'm also going to change this color. So opening Inspect Elements one more time. Here we can see the code that needs to be changed. The style is on the right hand side, and we can see the blue palette right here next to the A, and in CSS, A refers to a link. So we need to change this color to the emerald green kind of color, the aqua color, so I'll just do that there. Then I'm going to copy this code, highlight it and copy it, then close my window here and go back to the custom.css file. So I'm going to click on Dashboard, then go down to Appearance, click on Editor, click on custom.css. Then I'm going to scroll to the very bottom and paste the code that I just copied in the previous step, making sure that I close it out with a closing tilde bracket. So for CSS, we have the A, which is a link, and the new color, and we're good to go. I'm going to click on Update File to update the file. Now going back to the site by clicking on Visit Site, now when I scroll down, we can see the link is now this kind of emerald turquoise color and it matches the rest of the site. Okay, great. So we're pretty much good to go on the homepage. Let's take a look at some of the internal pages, starting with the blog page. So looking at the blog archive page here, we see that these two buttons are blue, which really doesn't go very well with the other colors on the site. So I want to change the colors of these buttons, and I'm also going to change the background color of this email opt-in box. So opening up Inspect Elements, I'm going to click on Inspect Element. Here we can see on the right-hand side, we have the dot sidebar dot e-news dash widget, and we have the background colors currently at this 2 number, which is kind of a darker color, kind of like a black. I'm going to change that to the same color that we used on the home page for the excerpt box so that it's consistent. I'm going to keep it like that. Then I'm going to highlight and copy this code. Then close my Inspect Elements and go back to my custom.css file. Going down to Appearance, clicking on Editor, and then I'm going to click on custom.css, scroll to the bottom, and paste the code that I just copied in the previous step. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Now when I go back to visit the site by clicking on Visit Site, and then I go to blog, now we see that the color of this email opt-in form matches the same box on the homepage where the image slider is located. Okay, next I'm going to change the color of these two boxes from blue to a color that is more complementary on the page. So I'm going to change these two boxes to a kind of green color that matches the color in the rest of the website. So to do that, here I'm just going to hover over Inspect Elements and click on Inspect Element. Then we can see that it's crossed out here, but actually when I add it in, this is kind of an exception. Note that I'm just going to copy this code right now, highlight it and copy it. And then note when we go back to the site, here it has turned this emerald green color, which is great. Then I'm going to go back to my style sheet by clicking on Dashboard, going down to Appearance, hovering Appearance, clicking on Editor, then clicking on custom.css, scrolling to the bottom and pasting the code that I copied in the previous step, closing it with a tilde bracket. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update my file. Now going back to the site by clicking on Visit Site and clicking on Blog, now we can see that we have the button is now the emerald color. So I want to create the same color for this background right here so that instead of blue, it's also an emerald green color. So I'm going to open up Inspect Elements once again. Here we can see on the right-hand side the style for this comment background color right here. So I'm going to change that to this emerald green color. There we go. Then I'm going to copy all of this code, highlight it and copy it. And then as we have been doing all along, I'm going to go back to Dashboard, go down to Appearance, click on Editor, click on custom.css, scroll to the bottom, and then I'm going to paste the code that I copied in the previous step, closing it with one of these tilde brackets. Then I'm going to click on Update File to update the file. Then I'm going to go back to my website by clicking on Visit Site, going to my blog page, and now we can see that the colors match really nicely. Now note when I hover over the title here, the blog title, it still turns blue. So that is an issue. We want to make sure that we get rid of all the blue on the site and we turn it to this emerald green color so that it blends well with the rest of the site. So I'm going to open up Inspect Elements one more time. And this time we actually have to hover over this HTML code here, and on a Mac you want to hold down the control key, and when you do that then you'll get this force element state right here. So we want to see the code when we hover over this link. So I'm just going to click on hover right here, and then here we can see on the right hand side the CSS style for the hover condition, the hover style, and here we see here's the blue. So I'm going to click on that and change it to my green. Then I'm going to highlight this entire code. This is all the hover code right there. I'm going to highlight that and copy it, and then I'm going to add that also to my custom.css file. So I'm going to go down to Appearance and Editor. Then I'm going to click on custom.css and scroll to the bottom, and here I'm going to paste the code that we copied in the previous step, closing it with one of those little tilde brackets. Okay, and here we can see that the A is the link, and then we have the hover code. So we have .entry-title A colon hover. We also have the entry title, the footer widget entry title, and then we have the A hover too. So this A is the link, the hover is the hover state of the element, and we have the color. Now I'm going to click on update file, and now I'm going to visit the site by clicking on visit site. Now when I click on blog, we can see when I hover over this particular link, now it turns the same color as the other kind of emerald green colors throughout the site. So everything is really consistent, which is great. So if you've made it this far in the video, congratulations, because you should have a completely customized professional business WordPress website using the amazing Genesis Framework by StudioPress and the Executive Pro Child Theme. In this video, we've completely customized the entire theme, and we've added all the bells and whistles of a professional WordPress website, including things like calls to action, Google Fonts, email opt-in forms, video, social network icons, photo galleries, landing pages, contact pages, and so much more. I hope this video was helpful to you. If it was, please feel free to leave a comment below, like the video, and share the video with your friends. I will be coming out with more videos related to WordPress and how to grow your business on the web, so please subscribe to my YouTube channel. Last but not least, all the conversation continues on my website at 77webstudio.com, so feel free to head on over to my website to continue the conversation. One more thing before I sign off, I just want to mention that I've begun pinning things on Pinterest. So if you are on Pinterest, feel free to connect with me here. Here I'll be pinning things related to WordPress, themes that I love, quotes that inspire me, and much more. Also, if you're on Twitter, feel free to connect with me at 77webstudio. Until next time, I hope you have a great week and continue learning new skills that help you to build your business on the web.